And welcome everyone along the World Wide Web as we get set to roll into this 27th running of the Wiseco John Pinton GNCC. Hello everyone and welcome here to the Russell Family Farm once again as we have set the stage for what could be another historic day, as some 25 years ago, Barry Hawk claimed his first ever win in 1991, the first of 68. And the big question is here today, can he continue his winning traditional ways with his new rider in Bryce O'Neill, who is going to be lining up here in the XC1 Pro Class in just a few moments. But of course, he's got his hands full with the contingents that are going to be lining up side by side with him today, as of course, we get set to meet the greatest off-road ATV racers in the world. Rolling to the line first today, he hails from Rogers, Ohio. He has 3 wins and a 7-point lead. Your current and defending GNCC ATV champion from on an Infab Maxxis Yamaha, backed by LSR, MXP, and FMF, Walker Fowler. Rolling to the line next, he rides aboard the 521, currently second place in points, but only 7 points out of the number one position. Off of a 3-win race streak, heading into what possibly 4 race wins in a row here today. He hails from West Union, West Virginia on a CST Tires, LSR Induction Solutions, DeRisi SG, Tire Blocks Backed Honda, Adam McGill. Rolling to the line today, 3rd in points. He rides aboard the number 5. He hails from Bidwell, Ohio. In points, he is a 6-time GNCC champion. He is also the record holder with the most GNCC wins in history. Nearly taking the win 2 weeks ago, coming up short. He's back for vengeance today on a Maxxis Fly Racing Amsoil-backed Suzuki from Sunbury, Pennsylvania, Chris Borich. Rolling to the line next today, aboard the number 3 from Casco, Pennsylvania, on a JMR ATVriders.com DWT backed Honda, we call him the Sneaky Snake, it's Jared McClure. Rolling to the line today next, he is 6th in points after a rough start to the season due to physical illness. He is back on track today out of Edinburgh, Pennsylvania, on an Infab Maxxis backed Yamaha, your former XC2 Pro-Am champion, the Coltrane Cole Richardson. Rolling to the line next, he is 7th in points, riding aboard the number 11 from Manchester, Maryland, on a show hauler, Canyon Motorsports GBC backed Honda, LW Landon Wolf. Our next rider, he is 8th in points. He rides aboard the number 14 from Akron, Ohio, featured on the event t-shirt this weekend, on the BNR Maxxis Moose Racing backed Yamaha, Josh Merritt. Rolling to the line next, he is 9th in points, riding aboard the number 10 from Aurora, Ohio. A GNCC racing career that spans over 30 years, 20 of which in the XC1 Pro class on a GBC HMF Fly Racing Yamaha. It's Aurora, Ohio's Johnny G, Johnny Gallagher. Rolling to the line next, aboard the number 9 from Mount Pleasant, Pennsylvania on a Maxxis, or a Precision Axis Pro Graphics Maxxis back machine, Jay Shadron. And last, and certainly not least, he rides aboard the number 816 from Grain Valley, Missouri on a Shockworks Motorsports Exit RSF FX GBC Tires backed Honda, Tucker Wyatt. And that, ladies and gentlemen, your starting lineup for the XC1 Pro Class here at the Weisscoat John Pinton GNCC. As we said, we celebrate 27 runnings here today as our 26 years upon us. It all began, like we said, back in 1990, believe it or not. This is the longest standing GNCC on the circuit. And friends and family, gather around, because today is certainly going to be a day of historic proportions. I'm quite sure what's going to happen. Will we have a new points leader when it's all said and done? Will it be a tie points race? Will that not even be a factor? Will we have a brand new first time ever winner here? Or will it be none of the above? Time will certainly tell the story on that one, and that will be about 2 hours worth of that time that we have to wait to find out what the final pages have to be written here at the Weisscoat John Pinton GNCC. We turn our attention up to Ricky Towery there in turn number one, as he is our conductor of ceremonies. He is waiting for the official word from Scoring and Timing and also from the sweep crew that the track is ready to go, and Scoring and Timing is ready to go as he signals the riders on the starting line. 1 minute. 1 minute before the start of the John Pinton GNCC. So all systems are go here in southeastern Ohio, a mecca of off-road motorsports, right here at the Russell Family Farm. And folks, you can feel the anticipation in the air. That's not humidity today, which, by the way, it is the hottest and most humid day so far of 2016 as far as the GNCC is concerned. Blue flags are out. Shut them down, guys. Shut them down. Shut them down. Shut them down as we're about to go. And I got to ask you, Ohio race fans, are you ready to go GNCC racing? Come on, Ohio. We're in the mecca of off-road racing, and that's all we got. I think you all could do a little better than that. Let's try this one more time. Ohio, are you ready to go Weisscoat John Pinton GNCC racing? 10 seconds. And row number one, the XC1 Pro will be off and rolling at the Weisscoat John Pinton GNCC. And if you notice, down on the starting line, Bryson Neal starting off backwards from an infraction that he suffered their last race. Started his bike a little early. And the number four of Chris Borch is going to pick up $250. But it's going to be the Yamaha of Walker Fowler, I believe, taking to the early lead in this one. But the $250 going to Chris Borich out there. Pro-Am class coming up next. Welcoming back Kevin Yoho along with Marty Christofferson, Randy Hamilton, Braden Henthorne, Greg Covert, James Green, Kenny Schick, Matt Hanna, Levi Cohen, Wes Kinsley, Andrew Connors, Cody Collier, Danny Rogers, Bryson Hopps, Matthew Lindell, Ryan Thompson, Cameron Bruce, Brian Foltz, Dwight Pollard, Wesley Wolf, Michael Lancaster, and Devin Masters all ready to roll in 10 seconds. And they're off. A start early on the number 12 of Yoho, but it's the 21 of Greg Covert out of Ithaca, New York. Covert brought to you by High Gear Suspension, Waynesburg, Yamaha, and Moto Experts, grabbing the early lead out there. Yoho will be penalized at the starting line with a 30-second infraction there, or 15, depending on what the infraction will be. College A coming up next. Evan Fion, Mason Wallace, Drew Landers, Nick Royalty, Hunter Hart, Alec Matthews, Logan Wagaman, Weston Scott, also Jacob Scott. We got Brandon Eicher, Peyton Atkins, Brayton Schick, along with Seth Wilson, Corey Silverthorne, Wyatt Wilkin. 10 seconds. Sean Keffer, Zachary Jones, Torin Johnson, Tyler Ware, Shane Kittle, Tanner Walker, Bodie Lamoureux. Off and rolling in our College A class now. It's rounding the first turn. The whole mass is. And I believe that's 217 of Drew Landers out of Monterey, Tennessee, grabbing the early lead in that one as we move down to the Junior A 22-plus class coming up. Steve Covert, Nathan Hornacek, Cody Wolford, Nicholas Mastrangelo, James Mauger, Sean McCormick, Matthew Lamberti, Robert Matt, Brett Cover, Jeff Miller, Noah Landis, Jared Little, Luke Shepard, Seth Mumford, Dustin Biggett, Josh Konacek, and Sam Ho all ready to roll as Ricky Tyree sends them the dead engine call. We're less than 30 seconds away. And now Ricky Tyree readies these riders and lets them know 10 seconds. And they're off. 724, Luke Shepherd out of Marion, Ohio. Husband of Megan Shepherd, Manchak, actually. Megan Manchak Shepherd. She's the WMX, the Women's Motocross ATV Champion. And Luke is out front pulling out the lead in this Junior A class today. As we go to the Vet A 28 Plus class, AJ Koontz, the Marble Man, Todd Mascala. Also, we got Kenneth Kelly, Jeff Pickens. Oh, a big Papa P there. Dirk DeCesar, Eric Vallejo. We got Nicholas Camilli, Kevin Patterson, Josh Shaner, Walter Schumacher. 10 seconds. Joey Marcaria, Dustin Hendershot, and Adam Reed. And they're off. Wow, what a hot day. I'm sitting here standing, and I'm feeling the sweat and the perspiration already. I can only imagine what these riders are going to be faced with. It's the 98 Big Papa P. Jeff Pickens taking the early lead in this one now. As we go to the senior AB 38 plus class, Jeff Range, Rob Zimmerman, John Gower, Mark Batson, Rusty Repass, Andy Cooper, and Miles Muskopf ready to roll next in this one as Ricky Tyree lets them know it's time to go in 10 seconds. Senior AB off and rolling now. See if we can get a number on that as they round that first turn into the second turn. It is 7:04. I think Rusty Repass, quite possibly. College B coming up next. Got Scott Pearson, Donald Boylan, Christopher Driscoll, Morgan Flannery, Joseph Yerkson, Shane Pitzer, Travis Spencer, Mitchell Edelblut, Michael Anderson, Joel Smith, Bobby Duker, Riley Salick, Dustin Cooner, Caleb Hagen. 10 seconds. Justin Keller, Frankie Egress, Chandler Berner, Tyler Swindle, Lucas Birch, Corey Vandeliner, Eli Kiger, Ethan Petro, and Jamie Wells. And around the first turn, it's the 7-8 machine. That's Scotty Pearson from Windsor, New York on a Hauser Racing DP Brakes DMR back machine. Woo! The driest race we've seen in quite some time. Junior B, 22 plus class. And it's still not real dry here, believe it or not. Brian Felicki, Keller Skinner, also Nick Driscoll, Chris Ballou, Brett Fike, Tyler Willoughby, Evan Timko, David Kite, Charles Dawson, Travis Mathias, Jay Turner, Evan Soda, Joshua Wine, Jake Callen, Chris Kent, Justin Farrell, Jason Bush. 10 seconds. Roger Norman, Derek Murray, Kramit Nathan, also Travis Thompson, Ryan Bobus, and Jason Day. That is, whoa, I missed that. That guy went so fast. But the 840 Ryan Bobitz out of Chepachet, Rhode Island, out of Fox Racing Shocks, BH Trailers, NE Copperwork Machine. But I think he might have swung out way too wide, dropped back a couple of spots. But we go next to the Vet B 30 plus class, less than 30 for Jeremy Gouchard, Brian Locke, Alan Tuttle, Philip Thayer, Jason Dillard, Aaron Hendershot, Charlie Rogers, William Craig, Thomas Gother, Lyle Morrison, Jason Miller, West Spring, Brad Kearns, Chris Bennett, John Salsa, Corey Blickowitz, also John Colvin, Mark Smith, Christopher O'Neill, Matthew Briggs, Dale Batson. 10 seconds. Tim White, David Rutter, and Matt Miller. Ninth and final row off and rolling now, and it is the 671 of Dale Batson out of Ida, Michigan on the Media All-Stars Fox and Lone Star Racing back machine. Again, glad to have the folks from Media All-Stars with us. That one headed up by George Cortez, a group of riders that got together many years ago and took the ATV motocross scene by storm. And now over here in the GNCC side of things, which, by the way, ATV motocross starts, want to say Congratulations to a former ATV motocross rider who made his debut in GNCC today in the 16 to 19 novice class. Jeremy LaDon won that 16 to 19 novice class. I want to say congratulations to him for that. Welcome him to the Woods side of things. And that's going to do things out here on the start, folks. We'll be back with more GNCC Live when we continue right after this.
When it comes to protecting your engine, AMSOIL offers the next level performance truck owners demand. AMSOIL provides 75% more engine protection against horsepower loss and wear than required by a leading industry standard, extending the life of pistons and cams. Give the vehicle you love the above and beyond fortification it deserves. AMSOIL, devoted to protection.
Maxxis Tires.
Here at Rocky Mountain ATV MC, our goal has always been to get you the best price and provide quality service. Now, we're giving you one more reason to shop with Rocky Mountain. We call it Quick Cash. It's simple to get. Just place an order with a qualifying Quick Cash item and get cash to spend on your next order. Try it out today. RockyMountainATVMC.com. Get ready.
The Andersons discovered life is easier with an Outlaw RV. The Outlaw is a complete home on wheels with a multifunctional garage. Getting on the road has never been quicker. The Outlaw is made to fit the lifestyle of today's active families. So stop roughing it and start enjoying your weekends. Find the Thor Motor Coach Outlaw that fits your needs at GarageRVs.com today.
I'm a sore loser.
I'm a sore loser.
Losing is not an option for me.
Be the best.
The best.
The best.
You have to have the best equipment under the hood.
That's why I
only use
Kometic products in my engines.
Kometic gasket.
Kometic gasket.
Kometic gasket.
Kometic gasket, a superior quality gasket
for those of us who demand the highest level of performance.
Welcome back to GNCC Live here at the Millfield, Ohio, John Penton 100. That's really not the 100, but the GNCC here. And we're looking at the creek section right now with these guys coming through. You know, it's a really hot day out here. It's 85 degrees or so. But, you know, we've got some of this creek right here. These guys are getting a little bit of water. You know, we got some dust going on. But, you know, let's do a little replay here of the pro guys coming through here the first lap.
This is the 2 mile marker. Then they're going to go into the 4 mile marker as well. We've got both of them queued to play.
Okay, so right now we're looking at the 2 mile marker. These guys are coming through, and then we're going to switch to the 4 mile marker. But you can see they got some nice virgin section going on here, and we got Walker Fowler going first. Looks like Adam McGillen second. It looks like, you know, Walker Fowler's got himself a little bit of lead as he climbs this one of the big uphills at Millfield at the John Penton, and no trouble going up there.
Yeah, we saw some riders there earlier, Fred, having a bit of a trouble getting a good lineup through there. And as you see some of the pros bouncing, the key is not let that gas off.
There goes Adam McGill. There goes Chris Borch in third place. And I'm not sure who that was in fourth.
That looked like possibly a coastal machine.
Yeah, but, you know, you can see these guys are making this hill look really easy. And on TV, it doesn't look that steep. But that thing is really steep. And I think we got word that that was Cole Richardson in fourth place.
Yep, now pay close attention as soon as Johnny's out of this shot at where Richardson sits.
Okay, now I think we're going to switch to the next photo of these guys coming through the creek, maybe.
All right, leading back to that hill.
XC2 guys.
Watching our XC2 riders come through.
You know, and on the lead, did you see this guy on the Suzuki? I'm not sure who he is, but did you see the pass he made on the outside of first two turns to take the lead?
Unheard of, Fred. As soon as you started to mention, I was like thinking to myself, look at this guy going around the outside and held that lead for two turns off the start, and here he is coming up across the hill in the lead.
Yeah, looks like he was on a mission today. He knew he wanted to be in the lead as he headed into the wooded sections here at the John Penton. And look at this nice little virgin section. And the woods are really nice right now. It's nice and moist, and there's no dust in there. Out here in the sun's beating down on things in the motocross track, we're going to have a little bit of dust, but most of the racing is in the woods right now. So these guys really got good track conditions. You know, the hills are good. The trees are good. Right now we're coming to the creek.
You know, I asked several different riders on the podium this morning, overall conditions, and, you know, Michael Swift simply said perfect. He said the conditions were absolutely perfect. You know, naturally it's a little warm out on the field, a bit dusty, but not exaggerated, not heavy dust conditions by any means. And when you get into these woods, Fred, they look really good to me.
Yeah, sure does. You can see these guys coming the creek right here. You know, they're pulling some of the water up on the hills right here, so it's a little bit slippery as you go up the hill. But, man, the racing condition today for, you know, being almost in June, we've got a really perfect track. Things are really going good. So I expect some really good close racing today.
Well, I tell you what, based on what we've seen so far this season, and then when you add in the conditions, I 100% have to agree with you right here, Fred. We see a rider having some problems now. I saw him lose that momentum. But the good news is he's close enough to the top there. Oh, if he doesn't go bad here.
He needs to get off that quad right now.
Drag him up over the top.
Yeah, he needs to get off that thing and either drag the front end around or, you know, these guys are there to help him. So hopefully, that's bad news. Bad news. Look
exactly
out below.
What you didn't want to happen. Exactly what you didn't want to happen right there, the old barrel roll.
These people, look at that. The spectators there, they saved him a bunch of money. Because once a quad starts flipping, there's stuff going everywhere.
You know what? It's a bike cost times two when that thing starts rolling, no doubt about it.
That's for sure. Okay, let's talk about the John Penton a little bit here. You know, Adam McGill's really been on fire lately. Chris Borge is a guy I look to really have a good ride today after that last lap ditch effort to win that race. You know, that really showed me that Chris Borge really wants to win. You know, he freaking rolled the dice right there. He came up a little bit short, but he showed these guys he is for real.
Fred, we've said before, you have to cross the line. You have to take a chance. You have to make that decision somewhere along the line. And that's what separates champions and winners, is the ability to pick when to and when not to cross that line. And I tell you, Chris rolled the dice, laid it all on the table right there. Did not work out, but you know what? Wouldn't have worked out if he didn't try.
Yeah, you know, you're right. You know, and his confidence level is way up. You know, if he wanted to try that and he just rode around and got third or fourth or whatever, but he went for the win. So I look for him to have a really good ride here, but me being an Ohio guy, we're here in Ohio. I expect Walker Fowler to just say, okay, it's Ohio. I'm expected to win. This is it. I'm going to show you guys what we're supposed to be done here, you know, because he's lost some good points to Adam McGill. Adam McGill's been a roll, but this is where Walker Fowler needs to stop him. You know, we got the Ohio crowd. He's got everybody here. This is his race. I look for him to put the hammer down today.
I'm going to agree with you, Fred. So many times we see that come into play. A guy's having a lackluster season. A guy's doing a lot. But unlike Walker, Walker's got three wins. But you know what? There's something about that home crowd. There's something about that home track. Oh, no, our friend now taking out a few trees trying to get back on course there. But, Fred, I got to agree with what you're saying there. I look for Walker to really step it up today. We see he's out front. What an amazing line he pulled on that uphill right there. And already making it look kind of easy, Fred.
Yeah, you know, Adam McGill, Chris Borsch, the rest of the crew, Cole Richardson, even though he's not an Ohio boy, he's PA, but he's riding the line. So I look for him to make a good ride in today. You know, he's struggling a little bit. Look for him to be on the podium also. But these guys aren't going to let Walker Fowler just run away. They're going to keep the pressure on him, and it's going to be a dogfight all the way to the finish. And, you know, Walker's going to have his hands full. But I really do look for him to sit on top today and kind of reclaim his stake as far as where he started out this year by winning races and try to take a little bit of wind out of McGill's sail.
Yeah, I see that happen. And when you get that confidence level, when you're feeling the mojo, feeling the flow, that's when you have to take advantage and capitalize. And I believe that's the opportunity set forth in front of Walker right now. But here's the deal. You know, we're talking about these two guys. We haven't talked, other than Chris Borsch, we haven't really talked about all the other players and contenders in this game. Because I tell you what, second, third, fourth place has been no joke, no pushover so far this year, Fred.
No, definitely not. You know, there's been more than one person that can win, as we saw at the last race. It's just being able to cross the finish line to win the race. Bryson Neal, you know, he didn't know if you guys noticed on TV, but he started around backwards this race. He had to actually turn around because I believe, I'm not 100% sure, but he started his bike earlier or something last race. So this race here, they made him start backwards to kind of penalize him for the last race.
Right. Yeah, a bit of an infraction there. So turn that bike back around, not seeing when the starter drops that flag.
Okay, and you know what? You know, and then you got Chris Borch. He's sitting in fourth in points right now. You know, Bryson Neal's in third. Chris Borch is in fourth. We got Jerry McClure in fifth. We got Cole Richardson in sixth, Landon Wolf in seventh. So these guys are still in the game. You know, they're going to be there today. It's going to be a lot of close races. You can see the woods are really good. So these guys are going to be, you know, nose to tail, and they're going to be trying to make things happen. When you get out here on the motocross track, we're going to see who likes to jump and who doesn't. As you can see from, you know, a few other races, a lot of these guys spend more time on the motocross track because that's where a lot of this is gain and loss, you know, because there's, if you can jump some jumps and somebody else doesn't, that's a few seconds, and a few seconds means a lot.
You know, I'll use Wesley Wolf for an example. Wesley has an amazing track at his house. As we all know, Wesley kicks so much butt in the woods. But you know what? When you get that guy down at Loretta Lenz or you get him at Texas for ATV motocross, that guy drops the hammer. He wins consistently. And whenever you add this kind of track or this kind of motocross section into a GNCC track, you know he's going to make time. He's going to make passes. And a lot of these guys practice during the week on a motocross track.
You know, and that, and then too, being a moto guy like I was coming into off-road racing, I look forward to the motocross tracks. You know, I got through the woods the best I could, but when I got to the moto track, man, I was excited. It gave me more energy, and I went, you know, did all the jumps and did this and that, but it gives you something to look forward to. So it always keeps your head going forward. You just want to keep on going, keep being strong, do the best you can through the woods. I mean, you get to the motocross track and it's a blast. So that's what this is about.
Fred, we always talked about that with you. You know, you'd come out and you'd be the first guy to not even think, you know, you'd launch. And then what we'd watch, though, Fred, is you would take that to the woods with you, because the next thing you know, there'd be a ditch. Fred's filling the flow, man. He would bunny hop this ditch while everybody else is trying to wheelie through it and that kind of thing. So I believe what you're saying to be 100% true, man.
Yeah, you know, you get your confidence going, and you think you can do anything. And, you know, if your bike's set up right, like these guys really work hard setting up their suspension, working with their mechanics. So these guys can attack things so much harder than what anybody else can. You know, it's a lot to do with the bike setup. And, you know, and we talked about earlier about the pro guys coming through the creek.
But this is second, third, fourth.
Okay, and you can see how close these guys are. This is second, third, fourth, and fifth. And look at them. They're using different lines.
Yeah,
you know,
man.
They're really going after it.
That's what I like to see right there, Fred. You know, a guy's not waiting. A guy says, oh, you know, it's only 3 feet around that tree. Nah, man, that 3 feet means something to these cats right now. They're trying to take advantage of it. And whether it worked or not, I'm giving these guys props for trying those lines, man, because it won't try playing it won't work if you play follow the leader all day.
Yeah.
I will promise you, that pass will never stick if you play and follow the leader.
You're 100% right, Megawatt. If you're following, you're not going to get around them. So you got to make things happen sometimes right there in the creek like that. Those guys were trying, and, you know, now it's burn into the main line, so we'll be interested to see how many guys really go around there. And there's going to be definitely going to be some passing going on there. And you can see some of these guys are getting a little bit stuck right here and bottled up. And we got some of the spectators in there help pulling them up, a little bit of steam coming off the motor. But, you know, this is some fun racing going on down here in the creek.
Fred, when we see these guys bumper to bumper like this, we see the steam starting to flow. Sooner or later, there's going to be a couple bumpers locked up. There's going to be a couple tires locked up. These guys are going to be together. How does that come into play on a day like today, man, in these conditions?
Well, you know, I think the main thing is when these guys come up like this, they can't get excited. They can't try to make something happen. They need to just kind of wait and let it happen, because you get too excited, you try making a new line, man, you get your stuff really stuck, and then you're in a big trouble. So you're almost better just kind of wait a few seconds, lose 3 or 4 seconds, rather than trying to make something happen, lose a whole bunch of time.
I have to agree with you when you say that, Fred. So many times you and I have been there, and you see the guy gung-ho. He's coming from 4 spots back, trying to take out the rose bush, trying to go through.
Look at this guy here. He's raising his fist, but, you know, there you go.
Here we go, Fred. Just what I was talking about.
Yeah. You know, but that was a good, safe line there. He just jumped up on that bank, and you just got to make sure you got our spectators out of the way. Everybody's down there to help you, so don't run over to people that are trying to help you. Or don't, you know, bite the hand that's feeding you, as they say. But
exactly. But like we mentioned, there's going to be somebody get impatient. Guess what? There's going to be a whole new line. There's going to be a whole new section before it's over with down in there. And I have to say, with the vision issues you're going to have today, with the wet mud down in the creek, I'd say those kind of blockages are going to really come into play and could really have an effect on the outcome of today's race.
Oh, so there you go, right there. You know, these guys have already figured it out. And, you know, and one thing about this track kind of tracks like this, these GNCC track layer routers, they kind of see the stuff that could happen, so they always make alternate lines. Yeah, they may not be aero, but, you know, in their mind, they can look and say, okay, well, they could go up on this bank and get around, and that's exactly what they're doing. So, you know, they try never to make something one line to where if one guy gets stuck and it bottles everything up. You know, there's always an alternate route, but sometimes you just got to look for them to make it happen.
Yeah, what you can't have is you can't have constant bottlenecks week in and week out. You can't have nowhere to go. And like you said, the track crew here, every one of these sections, every one of these corners is laid out with basically an escape route. And what we don't want is we don't want 30 bikes stacked or 30 quads stacked in one section when everybody, here come the leaders, and everybody's waiting to get through.
Yep. You know, I'm looking kind of at the results from the last few years. You know, Walker Fowler won last year, 2015. 2014, he won again. So he's been on a roll those 2 years. But if you look back even further, 13, 2012, and 2011, it was Chris Borge. So Chris Borge had three wins in a row. Walker Fowler's got two. So, I mean, I'm an Ohio boy, and, I don't mean to be partial to somebody, but I think it's going to be Walker's going to put his third win in a row in today.
And we know Chris is on Old Yeller right now. He's feeling comfortable. He's feeling good, like we said. Rolled the dice there a couple weeks ago, really trying to make it happen. And that's what you need to see out of these guys. You have to see somebody make a move. Somebody has to take a chance. And I got to tell you, as soon as Chris pulled his helmet off, instead of being all jacked about it, Chris is smiling. He goes, man, I went for it, Megawatt. I tried, it was all or nothing right there. And I like that attitude. And, the fact that he realizes that it was all or nothing, and he had to grin about the try, even though it didn't work out for him, he knew it was necessary to make that attempt.
Yeah, Chris kept himself in the game the whole race. He made a move the last lap, and he came up a little short, but he had it for a second, so he knows he's back to where he needs to be. He's got Old Yeller working good at that event, so he's got his confidence back up. And as well as I do, that confidence is a whole bunch of this game. Your bike cannot be working so great, but if you tell your mind that you can win races, you're going to win races.
Let me tell you something. You want to talk about confidence? Now let's switch to our two-world friends, Trevor Bollinger. That guy, his confidence level, just a few little changes, a change in the team, a change in some equipment, and that guy's confidence level is all-time high. And look what it's done for him so far this season.
Yeah, I think the biggest help with Trevor is he's got a great team backing him. He's got team support, and that's all he needed. He was a great rider before, but he had to put all those little pieces together, and he had trouble doing that with the JCR team, with Johnny Campbell and those doing everything for him. Now all Trevor has to do is race. He knows the bike's ready. He's got pro circuit equipment on the thing, exhaust system and stuff, so he knows he's got a good bike. He's got good tires on it, Max's tires, so all he has to do is ride the thing, and that's what he needed.
That breeds the confidence. All those little things that you worry about, when you're operating alone, when you're fixing the bike, when you're driving, when you're the rider, when you're making all the arrangements, those things have been lifted from his shoulders right now, and you can see the difference in his confidence level.
Yep, all he has to do is ride, and that's part of being on the factory team, and that's what he needed, and he's showing he's the man, and that's what it's all about. And these guys are coming through Pro Road right now. And it looks like there goes Walker Fowler. And I'm not sure if that was just him all alone. If it is, he's got a giant lead right now.
Fred, that goes back to the home track. The mojo, he's feeling the flow right now. All right, just getting word, too, from our producer that Mark Notman built a brand new bike for this round. So we don't have a bike that has previous races on it. We've got a brand new machine set up to spec. And, they're always a little fresher. They're always a little tighter that way, Fred. And a lot of times, that's a confidence booster. And you can see what the confidence has done for Walker. The confidence has given him a 36-second lead.
Yeah, and there was Adam McGill coming in right there, like we said, in 36 seconds on the first lap. I mean, Walker Fowler has dropped the hammer on this one. It looks like maybe that was Cole Richardson maybe there in third place. So we got, Walker Fowler's doing exactly what I thought he would do. Coming back in here to Ohio, he's going to try to make a big statement right off the bat, and 36 seconds on the first lap is huge. You can see him right there on the motocross track. You can't see on the screen, but Walker Fowler's going up the double-double uphill section. He's coming back into view right now, coming down. There's going to be another left-hand turn here and another big double before he comes to the finish, which I would say Walker's probably going to jump this jump here. Up, and there he goes right there. So, Walker Fowler's been spending his time on the motocross track knowing that you can't afford to give an edge up to anybody on these races anymore. You got to be on your game in the woods and on the motocross track. Okay, and there's Walker going through the finish line right now. We're waiting to see where Adam McGill's coming right now. And Adam McGill's coming to that double-double uphill section right now. Rounding the turn, coming down towards the finish line.
All right, Fred and Matt stepping in with you guys right now to check in on what's taking place out here. Rodney Tomlin, of course, Matt Watson, and Fred Andrews here giving you the call on RacerTV.com and GNCC Live as our leaders now making their way in for the completion of lap number one. And wow, look at this gap that we've got between first and second place. I don't know whether Walker's trying to make some sort of a statement or what today, but a 37.9, call it 38 second lead over Adam McGill right now. So something happening out there that separated Fowler from the rest of the field. Richardson 13 and a half seconds behind McGill. Borch only 1.5 seconds behind Richardson right now. Bryson Neal, another 2.5 seconds back in fifth. Then we got Jay Shadron checking in the number six spot. He's 2.5 seconds off, and Landon Wolf in seventh. Those guys a little further back are kind of nip and tuck and nose to tail out there, while Walker really seems to have found the flow, as has Adam right now, trying to lay chase to him. It's early in the race. It's hot. It's a new bike that hasn't been through its paces yet, but one good thing about it is it's not going to be packing up that mud. It's not going to be carrying that extra weight and holding in that extra heat. So with Mark Knottman knowing this GNCC as well as he does, we have not seen any mechanical issues whatsoever out of Walker in the last couple of seasons. So that goes to show you this guy's probably got another bulletproof ATV underneath Walker Fowler. He's got that confidence rolling under him right now, and he's rolling with it here in the Buckeye State.
Yeah, you know, Mark Knottman's been around for a long time, and even though Walker Fowler's on a brand new bike, when Mark brings that bike to the races along with Chris Borich and Cole Richardson and Adam McGill and those guys, these guys come to the races. Their bikes are almost like brand new every race anyways. These guys go through them head to toe looking for parts that might even be worn. If it even looks worn, these guys put new parts on it. So coming here with a new bike is a great thing, but I think more of it's just the confidence in himself that he knows, Walker Fowler knows he needs to get back on top of the podium right now. Adam McGill is, eyes on fire. He needs to take some wind out of that sail.
Speaking on fire right now, we got a major battle going on between the top three in the XC2 Pro Am class. Cody Collier, the number 201, is leading the XC2 Pro Am class. He's up to eighth overall after time adjustments. Greg Covert, who is the points leader in this class, is only 1.3 seconds back. There is Kevin Yoho right now with a 15-second penalty. Remember, he started a little early on the starting line and backing up to the start. If you happen to recall, Bryson Neal started backwards today, and that was because there was a start infraction penalty imposed on him that was not carried out at the last race. It did carry over to this race, and they started him off backwards. But you can see it didn't really seem to hurt Neal very much. He said he's been practicing those backward starts all week. He got the news on Monday, so it's not that big a deal to him. So he came in prepared for it mentally and physically. And you can see that it hasn't really slowed him down any, as he is fifth place there at the end of lap number one. But right now on the XC2 Pro-Am, Collier, Covert, and Randy Hamilton, another 5 seconds back in that number three spot of the class. That puts Hamilton in 10th place overall after time adjustments here early in the race. Jared McClure then would drop to 11th overall. Kevin Yoho checks in. They get imposed that 15-second penalty, which I'm sure allows Tucker Wyatt, Levi Cohen, and even Wesley Wolf to gain that time that is needed to get by. And we got trouble in the pits for one rider out there. That
Ronnie Gallagher in the pits.
Yeah.
He's got his goggles off right now, Rodney, and he's kind of shaking his head. And I wouldn't think he'd take off without goggles on, so he's not really not pressed for any time right now. He's just
something maybe, not right for Johnny G. And this, like you say, he's no dummy. He's not going to go out there without any goggles on a day like today. And you know it's got to be frustrating for Johnny. As we pick up at the 2 mile marker, the action out front, there goes Walker Fowler. We caught a glimpse of him. Again, some 37, call it 38 seconds later is when we expect to see. So right there, we're going to say at the bottom of that hill, 31:25 for Walker Fowler. So we'll see what that gap is now. Is it still in that 40 second range as Walker weaves his way through down here? Is this anywhere near the rock concert or anything like that? That is the FMF PowerPoint down there, so that's what we got going on down there. That's a nice little hill climb. Offers up some challenge on the downhill side of it, as well as weaving your way through and back around. There's some big rocks down there. It doesn't look real challenging. You get a good heated race going on through there, though. It all of a sudden becomes a very critical part of the track there, Fred Andrews.
Yeah, Ronnie, as you can see how much their bikes are working. These uphills are rough. These guys got them nice and handling so well, it makes it look easy. But these hills are definitely rough. It looks like Adam McGill, he shoots up that hill. You can see he's kind of, he jumps, he lands, he jumps, he lands. He keeps the front end up to soak up those bumps. But, man, he's really going up the hill fast. It looks like he's actually putting some time on Cole Richardson, who wasn't third place. And I think that's Bryson Neal right there in fourth place.
Wow, we got a battle. It looks like he's trying to go for the pass right here, but he's not able to make it, as it looks like.
And Chris Borges is right on him, too. So, you know, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth are all together, Rodney. We've got a heck of a race going on.
Yeah,
right,
we do. Up the FMF PowerPoint we go. There goes the seventh place ride. I believe that is Landon, or actually Jay Shadron and Landon Wolf following behind as well. There's LW right there on the number 11 machine, as we watch that rider from Manchester, Maryland, work his way up the FMF PowerPoint here at the two-mile marker for the Wiseco John Pinton GNCC. We are right now about 33 minutes into a scheduled near two-hour race. Walker Fowler, Adam McGill, Cole Richardson, 1, 2, and 3 with Borch. Bryson Neal right behind him. And Jay Shadron and Landon Wolf in that number 7 spot. As we told you, Cody Collier, leader of the XC2 Pro-Am class, is 8th overall. Covert is 9th. And Randy Hamilton, who is 3rd in that class, rounds out your top 10 overall. And we should be getting, I think, a visual on those riders coming through pretty soon, if not already there, Fred. I need to get my sunglasses off and get my regular glasses on, but...
Yeah, I believe that was Jared McClure right there just going up the hill, Rodney. He was must have ran in some trouble. He's back there in 11th place right now. But, you know, we talk about Walker Fowler, Rodney. For him to get that much of a lead, you know, I could say maybe the dust slowed the guys down behind him because he had clear vision. But,
right,
man, these woods are perfect right now, so... I think Walker just put the hammer down.
Oh, I think you're absolutely right. I was talking with Walker last night, and I'll have this interview posted next week. But I interviewed he and Adam McGill last night in the Pro Pits, and that did kind of like a little track smack thing going on there. And Walker comes in here with, a truckload of confidence. I mean, he feels like Ohio is his home. Obviously, it is his home. He feels like John Pinton is his home. He's got the win here in the last, two seasons? I think he's working that three seasons in a row. And, you know, when you talk history to him about how well Chris Borch has done here, taking 6 wins, and traditionally it is a PA rider that has won like 12 or 13 times in the ATV class, and Ohio riders has only been like just a handful. And Walker is only one other rider from the state of Ohio that has ever won a GNCC here, and that'd be Kim Coonley, who he informed us actually got him into GNCC racing.
On a Banshee.
And the thing about it is, the odds, you look at that, are kind of stacked against him, but the odds in his confidence level are stacked for him. And you could tell last night by the way he was talking, he'd come in here to win today. And honestly, I really, truly in my heart believe that Adam McGill has done the exact same thing.
Yeah, you know, Adam McGill, he comes to win every race for sure, but I'm with you on Walker Fowler. You know, this is our home state. It just seems like somehow you get some extra energy, or just seems like things happen to go your way when you're in your home state, when you got a lot of fans here and a lot of people expecting you to win, and it just, you don't really put the pressure on yourself. It's a weird kind of feeling. I'm really trying to struggle how to explain it to you, but when I came here, I knew I was supposed to win. I had too many people I was going to let down, Rodney, so it's just, man, you just dig extra deep and things seem to happen.
Wow, I guess, and that's, you know, again, we keep talking about confidence, and confidence carries you a lot of places out there, and confidence even outweighs talent sometimes, not all the time, but oftentimes it'll happen.
Yeah, you know, and the confidence thing too is even if your bike's not working and you got the confidence that things are going right, you can make it work right. You know, if you're in shape and your confidence levels up, good things seem to happen, and that's where Walker Fowler's at right now. You know, we talked to him a little bit earlier, and I talked to Mark Nauman about the bike, and yeah, they got a new bike and they're ready to go, and Adam McGill, and they're ready to go, and here right now we're coming to that creek section again, and you can see Walker Fowler went around that little up and over thing, you know, so he's in the lead right now. He's not really pressed for time looking for lines like that. He's just staying where he knows is good, just trying to keep his momentum going,
trying to stay smooth and out of trouble, and continuing forward momentum. So Fowler,
and here comes Adam McGill. You know, Adam McGill took that little shortcut. Did he get any time? I'm not sure, but, you know, it looks like a good line right there. And Adam's having no trouble getting through that creek section. What you can't really tell is There's a lot of shale rocks in there. I think big pieces of shale are really slippery, like big rock ledges, and these guys are making it look really easy, where the bike guys tomorrow, you're going to notice, they're going to be bouncing around on that a lot. And there's Cole Richardson. He's still in third place. Nope, that's Bryson Neal. Bryson Neal has passed Cole Richardson for third place.
Wow, so that being started backwards. You know, I got to think, and I was thinking about this, that might be an incentive for Bryson Neal, because he's going to come out with a little extra adrenaline off that start, and we can see that it has carried him well into the solid top five and now up to a third place position now, so that's pretty impressive as we see Landon Wolf making his way by. That was your seventh place rider in the XC1 Pro Class and the overall at last check, and I believe that's where he still sits. Jay Shadron, the number nine, checked in at the finish line just a couple of seconds ahead of him. I don't know if Jay was just ahead of him there or not, but
I think Jay was right behind Chris Forge as they came through.
Oh, okay, so he's actually stretched it out just a little bit then.
Yeah, they were all together right there.
There's the number three of the Snake, Jared McClure, who is 11th overall. That is eighth in the class there, so he is still riding in his original position physically on the track, but time adjusted there. It has gotten a little different on the standings as those XC2 Pro Lights riders of Collier, Covert, and Hamilton have gotten in between he and Wolf. The gap between McClure and that seventh place ride, though, was 34 seconds. So that was a pretty monumental gap that we had developed there. And that's really odd. And, you know, maybe the dust in the fields, or at least on the moto track, might be a little bit of indication or something like that. But we are seeing a lot of changes there in the battling. I mean, we're not used to seeing these big gaps. We're seeing a few riders and then big gaps, a few riders and big gaps. And the last couple of races has traditionally been a little bit different. So this is a little different race day, and we still got a lot of room for things to change and progress throughout this day. I'm still up in the air, man. This one's, I think, a long, long way from over.
Yeah, Rodney, for sure. It's definitely a long way from over. As you can see, we just saw Walker Fowler go through this section here on the screen a little while ago, and he was going for it. And you can see Adam McGill went by there, too. I mean, Adam McGill is still trying to inch his way closer to Walker Fowler. He's not going to, you know, he's not giving up right now. This race, like you said, Rodney, we're only through the first lap. We got a lot of racing left to go. Adam McGill knows he has to keep the pressure on, keep as close as he can. And right now, here goes Bryson Neal with Cole Richardson right on his tail going by the screen right now. And these guys are, there's Chris Borge and Jay Shadron should be next, right? Yep, there goes Jay Shadron. So these guys are all still close, Rodney. They're all, this little group right here could be dangerous, because these guys get together and they start pushing each other. They can actually carry themselves even closer to the front guys. It's a little bit harder when you're in the lead to know how fast you're going, if you're going the right way, or, you know, just to keep your momentum going. When you're in a little group like that, all four guys could be pushing each other, Rodney, and this can actually carry you towards the front, and you don't even know you're going that fast because you're always racing, you're always pushing somebody. And it also helps you when you catch up to lap guys, because that first guy in that group is revving his motor, yelling and screaming, and as soon as that lap guy moves out of the way, man, next thing you know, there's one, two, three, there's four guys going right by. So it's like a little freight train that you can just stay on these guys and get past some lap riders a lot easier. And you know, like, you know, look at the track right here. Like I said earlier, the track is in really good conditions right now, so I look for a lot of these guys to stay really close together. Not here on the motocross track, it is a little bit dusty, but it's not that much of the moto track to really be a factor to separate these guys to keep that distance of, you know, far apart. These guys should be close racing all day long. And here we are back at the One Creek section again, and this guy here was trying to use that little short inside line. He made a little bit of bad judgment, went up on the bank there, but he backed down and got back over. And here we are at the FMF PowerPoint hill climb, and man, these guys are going up that hill almost as good as Walker Fowler and the crew were, but, you know, they're struggling a little bit here and there, but that's part of the you know, like I said, the bike setup situation. The Walker Fowler crew, these guys were working, getting their bikes set up, and Adam McGill and Bryson Neal, and these guys have really got their bikes working good for these hill climbs, and it does affect you on the climbing these hills, Rodney.
I'm sure it does. What else is I'm noticing out here, Fred, is we got a kind of a bright, sunshiny day today, and we got a lot of foliage. The leaves are in thick, full bloom here on the unofficial kickoff to summer 2016 in a Memorial Day weekend, which we salute all of our past veterans and those that have gone on before us and given their lives for our rights and freedoms, and we salute them that we can celebrate the unofficial kickoff here this this weekend. And of course, with that, I got to ask the question: the thick leaves. We're seeing a lot of shade, but we're also seeing a lot of bright sunshine come through there. Is that going to play havoc with these guys at any whatsoever today, or is that something that you think they're going to be able to adjust to? Because really, we haven't seen a lot of that this year.
Yeah, you know, on a day like today, you kind of want to wear tinted lenses because it's bright out here in the open, but you get in the woods and it's dark, just like you said, Rodney, and you go from the dark to light, and your eyes have a hard time adjusting. So I would want to wear just clear lenses because that way it's just constant, the same the whole time. Because if you wear a dark lens, you're good in the open, but then when you get in the woods, it can be real dark. And you know, there's a lot of little rocks and roots and stuff. You've got to be paying your attention at these GNCC races, so I think that's definitely going to be a factor. If you got some dark goggles, you're going to might even be wishing you would never wear them.
And I'm sure with the sunshine out and things, some folks are probably thinking that may have been the way to go, as well as they may find out the hard way that might not have been the way to go. But
and a lot of another stuff, Rodney, like you said, sorry to interrupt you, but like with the foliage, is the air can't get through there.
Right.
So those leaves are keeping away. So even though it's hot out here in the open, it's even hotter in the woods because that heat cannot get out. It's just hanging in there.
Yeah, and it is very humid out today by comparison. Now, this is not your typical August sunshiny, humid day by no stretch of the imagination. But honestly, man, Mother Nature brought us a full taste of what summer is like. We've been dealing with temperatures in the 50s and 60s the last few weeks, and nighttimes down into the 30s. Heck, a week and a half ago, we had frost here in southeastern Ohio, believe it or not. And here we are today, pushing near 90 degrees, and the humidity level any humidity in the air is going to be more than what we've had in the past, but it's certainly starting to climb up there. And I was looking at the forecast, and you know, weatherman says a chance of showers moving in about 3 o'clock this afternoon, which would be close to the end of today's race. So it may or may not affect them if some rain showers do come through. But I'm sure for a lot of these riders, it might be a welcome thing to get cooled off during this race.
Yeah, right. You know, here in Ohio, this time of the year, even though the skies are blue right now, it could rain at any moment. So you never know what's going to happen. And I think throughout all the years I was here racing that, it's either hot and dusty or it was a mud race. I don't know that I've ever had a perfect race here at the John Penn. You know, it's that type of weather. It's that time of the year. It's either hot or it's muddy. You know, we can get a rain at any moment. And, you know, if it did rain at 3 o'clock today, it is only going to make it better for tomorrow.
Right.
You know,
I have
a little bit less work for Jeff Russell and his crew because, you know, I'm sure tonight they're going to rip this motocross track and they're going to put a lot of water down. I'm sure they'd be happy to let Mother Nature do it for them.
Oh, yeah. Mother Nature is certainly a nice aid and assister in certain circumstances, but I'm sure at the same time, Jeff would be happy to get the water truck out for a change. That's something set apart quite a bit here lately. But nonetheless, as we roll on here, you can see that FMF PowerPoint is taking its toll on some riders, and though it may, you know, it's always deceiving to look at these things on television. I don't think you really get the full effect of what these hills and these challenges that these riders face until you go out there and look at it in real person. And even in high definition, man, there's no way to translate to people what these guys are being faced with out there.
Yeah, Roddy, you're 100% correct. You know, these hills on TV right now doesn't look that bad, but if you were out there standing at the bottom of it, you know how steep and how big they are. It's like, I'm sure a lot of people watch Supercross on TV. You look at those jumps on TV and you think, oh, shoot, I could just jump those jumps. So those whoops ain't that deep.
Right.
When you go to stand down there, they're like way steep. Yeah, TV just can't show the justice of how big things are, really. And these guys are doing an awesome job just by making these hills.
Oh, yeah. I know that Jared DeBolton, during his track description today, was even telling the guys, you know, a lot of the morning guys and gals were having some problems on one of the hill climbs out there. He says, just, you know, choose your line wisely and do it. You can make it up the hill. It's just a matter you got to be dedicated to it. So, you know, I'm sure, you know, this may be a challenging hill, but I think there's even more challenges that lie out here on this racetrack for these ATV racers today.
And when you come to the hill, Ronnie, it's just like any other part on the track. You kind of got to come out and you got to look up the hill to see if the line's clear, because you don't want to start up that hill if a guy's stuck. So these guys are just, when they come out of the turns, they look up the hill. If it is got some guys in it, they might go right or they might go left. But it's a big thing to actually look. You know, just like going to a mud hole, you got to look for a good line or watch somebody else go through it. So these guys kind of look up the hills to make sure nobody's in their line, and then they attack it and go right on up them.
We are now about 47 minutes into the Weisco John Pinton GNCC as Rodney Tomlin, Fred Andrews, and own Megawatt Matt Watson giving you a call here today on RacerTV.com. Walker Fowler leading right now, and at last check, some 40 seconds ahead of second place ride, Adam McGill. Just note of interest, Walker Fowler is now ranked fifth in all-time ATV wins. He has 22 ATV wins. He is fifth behind Bob Sloan, who has 24 ranked there in fourth rankings. And with the win today, that would put him one step closer. And another win with time. So Walker is getting pretty close to climbing up in the history books here. Now, one thing to point out, between Bob Sloan and Barry Hawk, who has the third most GNCC ATV wins at 49. Yeah, there you go. There's 25 wins that separate that fourth place and third place position in the history books there as far as wins go. So, you know, one day maybe Walker Fowler will tie Barry Hawk, but, you know, it's a likelihood and a possibility they will tie Bob Sloan and quite possibly move into the fourth place position of all-time ATV wins.
Yeah, right, like you said, I'm looking at that too. I mean, Walker's got 22 and Chris Morse has got 73.
Crazy, isn't it? And think about this. This is now race number, he's gone through 13 and 19 races now that Chris Morse has yet to win a race.
Wow.
The last race he won, again, remember we talked about 13 races last year, 6 rounds this year. He's been 19 rounds without a win. Almost came away with that win there 2 weeks ago. But today, you know, watching, and right now, as we approach the near 1 hour mark in this, he's nowhere near close to even contending for the possibility of a win today. Now, there's still a lot that can happen over the course of the next hour and 10 minutes or so, but one has to begin to wonder right now, you know, just how big of a margin Walker Fowler's actually going to win by.
You know, it's Walker Fowler's made a statement, like I said, these first lap and this second lap here. We're going to see if he's kept it the same or if Adam McGill is actually close time on him, because that'll say something. Now, if Adam McGill's starting to inch into it, then Walker Fowler's pit crew is going to say, hey, Adam McGill's starting to come, and Walker's going to have to put his hammer back down or put his head back down. But it's amazing that Walker's did this the first lap. I mean, he must really, really want this win today, you know, to put himself back where he needs to be or wants to be and try to put some points on Adam McGill, because Adam McGill's just been taking and taking and taking points. Sure, you know, he's been doing great jobs, Walker Fowler has, but he had a big points lead, and Adam McGill's just taking away little by little.
Well, we saw that puppy there in the window watching a little GNCC Live. That's how he hashtagged GNCC Live. We wonder how you're hashtagged GNCC Live. How do you watch GNCC, my friends? Just simply Instagram a picture of how you're watching GNCC Live for a chance to win, and make sure you hashtag it, GNCC Live, for a chance to win a Moto Tees event souvenir shirt featuring today Ohio's own Josh Merritt, the number 14 out on the racetrack today. 50 minutes now into this race. Again, last check, Walker Fowler, Adam McGill. It was Cole Richardson, but he has dropped now to at least fourth as Bryson Neal, at last visual check, was in the number three position on the race course. As we check in right now, we're about 3 minutes, a little less than 3 minutes, just over two actually, before we should expect to see our lead riders check in. Now, I'm not sure for longer or shorter here on lap number two, but I assume it's a little bit longer. So we may be a hair longer than the 222 that we're looking at. And there goes your leaders through the pro pits right now.
No, Rodney, I think the lap should be a little bit longer, because when they did the start, they didn't do the motocross track the first time. So they did the motocross last time, so it should probably be definitely not a little longer than 2 minutes.
I tell you what, I'm getting some word from our friends out on the racetrack that we are starting to see this race tighten up. Brett, I'm going to go out to the racetrack right now and look for some updates. Track crew, I understand that we've got some things tightening up out there as far as this battle is concerned. What are you guys seeing out there?
And while Rodney's
waiting
for an update,
coming to pro pits, just past the nine. He's got about 8 seconds.
All right, so McGill's coming toward the pro pits, and Walker Fowler's coming toward, and he said, did he say 8 seconds?
Yep.
There's Walker Fowler. 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, 1,004, 1,005, 1,006, 1,007, 1,008, 1,000.
Wow.
Wow, man, he is right there. He is right there. Adam McGill has made up at least 30 seconds on that lap of racing there. That's pretty phenomenal. You know, we were talking about how much time Walker Fowler pulled out, but look how much time Adam McGill was able to make up. The big question is, did Walker slow down or did Adam speed up that much? And I think the tail of that tape is going to come when we look at that third place position.
I think Adam McGill put the hammer down, Rodney, because Cole Richardson is
come back on that, Tommy.
And they were pretty close.
All right, I think I got it. He said Cole Richardson is crossing the road, if I'm not mistaken. So Richardson back there and Neil back there coming into the pro pits here in a moment. I believe we have two laps now nearing completion. Walker Fowler.
Rodney, and Adam McGill has definitely dropped the hammer. He cut that down to 8 seconds like he did. I did notice when Walker came in, he was getting some rags put on his handlebars, on his grip. So I'm not sure if his hands are soaking wet or if he may have got stuck and got his hands muddy. But
yeah, that's
they were drying his grips off, and he was trying to dry his hands off. But either way, Adam McGill's pit crew has got him fired up right now.
They certainly do. Watch what's going on as these riders make their way toward the two-lap car that's going out. We're here at Ricky Tower. Look at that. You wouldn't realize that was a GNCC racer on a moto track, but that's exactly what it is. He takes that like any top ATV MX star out there. There is Adam McGill doing the same thing, my friend, as he motors his way in. The official gap now after the pit stop and the time made up from 37.9 seconds, now 9.5 seconds. Call it nearly 30 seconds that Adam McGill was able to make up on Walker Fowler. Lap time 26:51 for Walker Fowler, 26:22 for Adam McGill. Friends, let me tell you, both these riders are on a mission today, and each one of them have the same mission statement, and that is to win. And this is only going to get better. And speaking of better, look at this battle coming toward the finish line right now.
Looks like that's Cole Richardson and Bryson Neal battling. I know Bryson Neal was ahead of him a little bit ago, but Cole Richardson is passing back as they do the double up here, Rodney.
A couple of former XC2 Pro-Am champions going at it right here. While one was graduating, the other was coming in on his heels, and this is really the first time we've seen these two riders square off, and Cole Richardson and Bryson Neal like this, and here they go at the near 55-minute mark at the White's Coat John Pinton GNCC, the home race, if you will, the Bidwell Bullet of Bryson Neal, who sits now in that number four spot all over Richardson. The Cole train is rolling, there's no doubt about it, and this is the ride that Cole Richardson's been looking for there, Fred Andrews. If you remember, he started out with those stomach issues. They thought it was all stemming from his Crohn's disease that he has been suffering with since he was a small child. Come to find out, it was more of a virus or a bacterial infection and not related to the Crohn's, but it had a lot of the same symptoms. That was a good blessing in disguise for that rider, believe it or not, that he was able to realize that. They were able to work through it, and you can see that now Cole, obviously back up to speed, is certainly a force to be reckoned with out here now, as he is now one of another amount of players. We can now say probably six different riders we can look at possibly taking a win on any given day, and that's pretty impressive when you look at this talent pool right now.
Yeah, Rodney, I was down there in the Ampro Yamaha pits earlier this morning, and I was talking to Cole Richardson about how he was doing. He said things have been going well, and he's really been working hard. He was looking forward to this race in Ohio today, to get himself a podium, to get him back into the game, and he's out there right now giving everything he's got. He's passed back into third place, so he's doing what he wanted to do to get in that podium position. And I noticed when Adam McGill was coming through the finish line right there, he ran to that corner, Rodney, and I'm sure you saw it too. He had his left fist in the air. He is pumped up and he is ready, and that's bad news for Walker Fowler. When you get Adam McGill fired up like that and his confidence is going and he's catching you, look out.
When he's having that much fun, you're right, the confidence, when he's having that much fun, yeah, you're right, look out, because the confidence level is there, the speed is obvious there, he's feeling it, because he wouldn't be having as much fun, and things certainly are obviously flowing when you can take a 40-second gap and narrow it down to 9 seconds, knock off 30 seconds basically off that lap time of that rider ahead of you. You got to be feeling pretty confident about that. But, man, I tell you, the Richardson-Neal battle going on right now, really, we didn't take note of this, but Chris Borich is right behind that battle for the number three spot of Richardson and Neal. So Borich is still in the thick and hunt of things as far as that is concerned. The gap, though, between the second and third place position was a minute and 1 second from Adam McGill to Cole Richardson. And if you really watch what's going on out here, kind of keep an eye on Chris Borich. Walker Fowler, he's putting out a lot of energy. Obviously, McGill is, Cole Richardson is, Bryce Neal is. But Chris Borich looks like he's just back there cruising at the moment. Now, obviously, it's kind of effortless. He's not pushing so very hard because he's not trying to get around those guys. In the meantime, in that happening, he's also losing a lot of ground. As we said, a 101 break in between second and third place positions. That's going to be a lot of time to make up, even for a former champ like Chris Borich out there. So while he goes back and watches the game play out for the third place battle, he's at the same time letting the race slip away from him today.
Yeah, Rodney, I agree 100%. I think Chris Borich, he's not waiting and playing around. He's going as fast as he can. He's with that group right there because those guys can't afford to try to save energy. These guys are in top physical shape for this GNCC racing. They know they can make it the whole time full gas, and that's what they're doing. Walker Fowler and Alan McGill right now, they're not going to leave anything on the table. They're gonna, if they come off that track and they fall on the ground and they're out of breath and they need water, that's the way they want to feel. They don't want to leave anything on the table right now, and I feel the same way about Cole Richardson and Bryce Neal and Chris Borich. These guys are giving everything they got. As we see right now, Walker Fowler coming through the 2 mile mark, getting ready to come up the FMF PowerPoint.
You know, look at that.
He used a different line right there, Rodney. That's not the same line they've been using. So Walker Fowler's trying to experiment a little. You know, right now Walker Fowler, his head might be spinning right now going, if he didn't get stuck and Adam McGill's caught that much time on him, that's just making his head spin. And now all of a sudden he's thinking too much.
Yeah.
And Adam McGill is in his head, and that's not what you want to happen if you're in the lead.
That's right. You know, you can listen by the calculated word choices of Walker Fowler that though he tries not to upset the apple cart, he is trying to get inside the brains of all the competition out there. And at the same time, these guys are doing the same thing. But what a beautiful shot of the Sunday Creek Raceway facility. Look at that blue sky and those big puffy white clouds up there, man. What a beautiful day here in southeastern Ohio. But watching the timing and scoring, just give you a heads up, we got a new leader. There's third, fourth, and fifth right there as we're watching Richardson, Neal, and Borich. And there they go now.
Ooh, I think that was a pass right there, Rodney. On the outside,
yeah.
Another one.
Yeah, so they're going back and forth, swapping it out, another couple different line choices. That right line may be the hot line. Let's see. No, maybe not.
Well, it might be, Rodney. It looks like it turns to the right there.
Yeah, I think that right line might be the one that's taking those guys into position there. So pretty impressive stuff going on right there. Now, back to the XC2 Pro Am battle. I did want to update this for you guys as we are at the halfway point of this race, and we will check in with all of our classes here in just a few moments. But check this out. A couple things to note. XC2 Pro Am class leader, Greg Covert now. He is ninth place aboard the number 21 machine. College A, 16 to 21 year old racer, Devin Feehan out of Windsor, New York, is rounding out the top 10 overall. So we got an XC2 Pro-Am rider in ninth and a College A rider in 10th place overall. That, my friends, does not happen very often. Then in the number two spot of the XC2 Pro-Am class, that is Wesley Wolf. Wolf, wow, we've got some big changes going on right there. College A, Hunter Hart is up to 14th place overall. Randy Hamilton is third in the XC2 Pro-Am class now. He is 15th overall. And I'm wondering what happened to a couple of those front runners up there at the end of lap number one. Let's scan through some of these results and see if they're making their way in. There's Cody Collier. Collier has not checked in for lap two complete according to timing and scoring right now. So that is one of the big players that we see that has lost out in the XC2 Pro-Am class at the moment. But I think the rest of those guys are back at it. We see Covert there, and we see that Wesley Wolf, who was working his way up to the pack, is there in the thick and mix of things also. So Oh, man, interesting stuff. Kevin Yoho, who was actually stopped for a 15-second penalty, he's moving up into the pack. I'm going to break him down in that XC2 Pro-Am class itself to let you know how it's going. It's Covert and Wolf. There's a minute and 25 seconds that separate first and second place. Something big happened out there in the XC2 Pro-Am class. Randy Hamilton is 17 seconds back. James Green is fourth. Kevin Yoho up to fifth. Levi Cohen, who literally lives just out of the gate here at Millfield, is running in the number six spot. Marty Christofferson, this is kind of interesting, is back in seventh. Matthew Lindell at 303 in eighth. Bryson Hobbs in ninth. Kenny Schick rounds out your top ten. And still 13th place in the XC2 Pro-Am class, and no sign of Cody Collier. Again, at least in timing and scoring, unless he snuck through, and we didn't see him go through. So, man, we've seen some big changes taking place in that Pro-Am class today. I don't know what it was, but something really rocked the boat there.
Yeah, Ronnie, for sure, something went on right there. That's part of the GCC racing, you know. Just because you're winning doesn't mean you're going to win. There's so much stuff going on. There's so many obstacles. There's creeks and rocks and mud holes and uphills that, man, it's never over till you get to the finish. And it's amazing that, you know, you don't expect things to happen, and boom, there's just a lot of stuff going on at this event.
There most certainly is, you know. And Bryce and Neil kind of brought it up, you know, and I didn't really think about it. I always talk about Steel Creek as being one of those. And here's your leaders. There's Fowler making his way through here at the 4 mile marker. You can hear the crowd going on here at the 103 mark, an hour and 3 minutes into this race. There is McGill, still within that 9 or 10 second range in that number two position.
Yeah, you notice Walker Fowler, when he came to that section, when he started making that left-hand turn around that tree, he was looking over his shoulder, Rodney. I think he might be a little bit nervous.
Yeah, I think he might feel it. He might hear. Obviously, he's getting the pit board that he is being caught. And he's just trying to see physically whether or not he's doing it. I think he doesn't necessarily see him, but he knows he's approaching, so he's just checking back to make sure that he's not back there, or if he is back there, how strong he is coming.
And I think these top two guys have actually picked up the pace a little bit, Rodney. I think they're putting a little more time on Cole Richardson, Bryson Neal, and Chris Moore.
Well, their lap time's 26:51. Well, I tell you, actually, McGill, 26:22, and that was with a pit stop.
Wow.
That was with a pit stop, a 26:22. Everybody else, 27 minutes or longer.
Yeah.
27:08 is the fastest time. Actually, 27:06 is the fastest time by Bryson Neal, other than the top two riders.
Bryson Neal,
up to the number three spot, speak of the devil.
So we've got a heck of a battle with those two guys, Bryson Neal and Cole Richardson, battling back and forth. And like you said, Chris Borsch is just sitting there in fifth place, but he's not really sitting there. He's still going fast, but it just seems like he's just hanging out there.
But, yeah, exactly. He doesn't look to be pushing the envelope any. It almost looks as though he is just waiting for either something to happen or he's waiting to make something happen. I don't know what it is. Maybe he's just found a comfort zone there and he wants to stick with it for whatever reason. Man, I mean, the last couple of years have not been the best of years here for him at John Penn. Year before last, I think he finished 49th overall, if memory serves me correct. After winning this race six times, he and Bill Balance are the two winningest GNCC riders here at John Penn GNCC on the ATV side of things. They both got six wins apiece. And I know that Chris was wanting to make it number seven today, but Walker Fowler's looking to make it, what, number three for himself?
Yeah, you know, with Adam McGill and Walker Fowler going this fast, you know, Chris Borch, he's going to have to make something happen, you know. Last race when he was lingering back there, and there goes Walker Fowler by right there, I believe. But when Chris Borch was, you know, lingering back there in second or third place, it was different. But when you're lingering back in fifth place and the leaders are that far ahead, you can't afford to wait. You got to go. And, man, Adam McGill is on the gas right there, Rodney. You see that? He came through there, and I believe he's catching.
I think he may well be closing that gap up even just a little bit more. So it may not be long before the next time that Walker Fowler looks over his shoulder, he actually sees.
He's got that fly.
I got McGill about 10 seconds apart.
10-4, Jeff. We're going to be listening in on and off, so keep those updates coming. 106. That's an hour and 6 minutes into this race. Megawatt Matt Watson out getting the scoops on a lot of different things here today. And I think the biggest scoop right now, Megawatt, is it's hot. It's real, real hot.
I tell you, Rodney, you're right. It is hot out there. And when you say that, I walked down Pro Road just a minute ago, at least half a dozen machines boiling over, cleaning the radiators out, and doing everything they can to cool the riders and the machines down at this point, Rodney.
So, wow, that's kind of interesting, Fred. You know, we talk about the heat issues on a muddy day. You wouldn't necessarily, well, I don't know, think about heat on a non-muddy day, but when you get temperatures that are running a little warmer, I mean, can that be an issue today? I mean, because I guess what little bit of mud you do get on it, plus the air temperature, it's not going to cool down as fast. So I guess you can get as much trouble on a day like today as you can on a muddy day sometimes, huh?
Yes, sir. You know, on a day like today, it's different because that air's all stagnant. It's just that hot air hanging out in the woods. So on a muddy day, you know, you're kind of going and you get hot from moving around and fighting a bike in the mud, where this here, there's no rest from it. You're always in hot air. And when the slower you go, the harder you get. So, and if you do come up and have trouble, you stop somewhere, man, your body just overheats so fast. You can see that guy right there. He knows how to cool off. He's got that shirt off. But today's worse than a mud race to me. You got to make sure you got way more fluids in you today than you do a mud race, because your body is sweating all the time. You're overheating, and you've got to replenish those fluids. So these guys are probably going to be looking to get a drink bottle this time as they come by. They'll be having the drink bottle for their riders, because you've got to keep that fluid in you, because once you get thirsty, it's too late. Your body's already starting to dehydrate. And once you start to dehydrate, which is probably going to happen to a lot of these guys in the last lap, your body starts to cramp up. Your fingers start sticking to the bars. You can't get them to go forward to grab the levers. Your legs are cramped up. You can't hit the brakes. So this last lap, there's going to be a lot of people cramping up that didn't get enough water, Gatorade, or anything in their body.
Yeah, and you know, and it's going to take a lot out of you today. That's what happens out here. There's no doubt about it. Check out this crash that we got on the moto track right there. Man, that's a GNCC guy trying to play motocrosser for just a moment. Now watch. He's funny. Anybody see that? Anybody see that?
Man, that boy is tough right there.
Nothing but a thing, man. Nothing but a thing. Well, folks, there you go. An hour and now pushing 9 minutes into this. Walker Fowler leading Adam McGill. And now Bryson Neal back in the number three spot. Cole Richardson and Chris Borch shadowing him in fourth and fifth. GNCC Live continues right after this.
When it comes to guarding your engine, AMSOIL offers the next level performance enthusiast demand. AMSOIL provides 75% more engine protection against horsepower loss and wear than required by a leading industry standard, extending the life of pistons and cams. Give the vehicle you love the above and beyond protection it deserves. AMSOIL, devoted to protection. Maxxis Tires. CST Tires.
You smell it, you feel it, you can taste it in the air. Speed, man.
Full wide open.
Blast.
I don't really like high school too much.
Too booky, too take notes, learn this, and that's it.
Yeah, wild tech. That full-size motorcycle.
The feeling of taking them apart every day, putting them back together. Woo! I can't explain it. Everything I learned applies to now. Seeing your motorcycle that you put together ride around the track at 180 miles an hour. Oh, definitely rewarding. My name's Mike. My school's Wild Tech.
Get on the fast track to a career. Turn pro at Wyotech.
I've been with Liat for a lot of years, and I know the dedication they have for safety. When they told me they were coming out with a helmet, I signed right up.
Welcome back to GNCC Live here from the John Penton GNCC in Millville, Ohio, southeastern Ohio, the mecca of off-road, if you will. We want to know, how do you GNCC Live? Instagram a photo of how you're watching GNCC for a chance to win an event t-shirt courtesy of Moto Tees. And be sure and hashtag that GNCC Live for a chance to win. We'll start popping up some photos here pretty soon. I know our ATV motocross fans really sent us a lot of pictures and a lot of folks participating in that. Well, I'll tell you what, you know, we've been watching this game, we've been watching this race today, and I almost said game, and, you know, that's almost what it is, you know, coming into this one. Walker Fowler and Adam McGill, believe it or not, used to be best of buds, man, traveling partners. They've got a lot of old stories and stuff like that together, but, you know, coming into this one, though, you know, these good of friends as they are, they're also nemesis. And each having three wins apiece, Adam a little bit further behind the eight ball with that fifth place finish there at the beginning of the season, puts him just a few points behind. But you got to wonder, as we are here at the halfway point of the season, things are so going so well, is anything changing his game, or is he keeping things the same and moving forward?
It's definitely a big mental game with us. Biggest thing is, you know, everybody in our class is fast, and everybody can win races at any time. And with us, it is a big mental game. I wouldn't say anybody's in anybody's heads at this point. We're still, you know, we're just about, I think we're halfway through now. So with us being halfway through, things are changing. You know, we went from, we're six races in. We have three wins on my end, three wins on his end. And, you know, essentially this is going to be the deciding factor. I mean, who knows? It might be a curveball. Chris has definitely come to life. You know, Bryson could get it this weekend. We're close to his place. I mean, or we could even have a you know, a little sneaky snake throw a little a wrench in that. So, I mean, anything can happen. It's John Penton. I mean, we've been here. It's been dusty dry like it is today. Or it might be just a muddy, nasty mess by the end of our race. So you just never know with going into the Penton what it could be.
Boy, I tell you, he tells it about like it is, don't he? I mean, that's the truth. You never know what it's going to be in Penton. You'll start out with dry, dusty conditions like this and end it in some of the deepest, thickest mud you ever seen in your life. I don't know. I think it was, what, 2002, 2003? Probably one of the driest races I've ever seen. It was a race held more like June or something like that, maybe even in July. But dusty race here. You could literally follow the competitors around the racetrack by the plume of dust on that first lap that was rising up through the trees is how dusty it was. But, I mean, we've seen the dustiest conditions. We've seen the wettest conditions. We've also seen, and it's a fine line, but there have been some perfect conditions, at least for a few minutes, if nothing else.
Yeah, Rodney, I think I was here that year, that 2001 or 2002, when it was so dusty that, like we said, the foliage is so bad. The same way it works with the heat, it works with the dust. The dust would go up in the air, would catch some leaves, and it's got nowhere to go, so it would come back down, and we were literally having to stop the first lap. It got that dusty, so we couldn't even see where we were going, and, you know, if you got the start that day, you were gone. Today, it's not like that at all. You know, Walker Fowler got the start and got that big lead, but it wasn't because of the dust. He must have just put some good laps in and had some good lines going on, where now that Adam McGill's been able to reel him in, it's putting a new twist to things, Rod. You know, anything can happen. You know, we still got over a lap and a half left to go, and these guys are getting close, but two, Cole Richardson, Bryson Neal, and Chris Borich are close together too. So can those guys carry themselves to the leaders? Well, if they are, they got to start to make something happen this lap.
For sure, and you know, speaking of making things happen, Walker Fowler kind of feels like he's in that position, man. I mean, he comes into the season with three straight race wins, and all of a sudden, Adam McGill gets three race wins. He had a good cushion, and that cushion now down to 7 points, and coming into this weekend, Walker knows he's got some work to get done.
Just made a small error, and Borich slipped past with a couple hundred yards to go, and then, you know, he slipped right by McGill as well. And then had a little bit of a mishap in the corner and stuck it. And, you know, honestly, I was more bummed, you know, that I felt like I earned third versus second. And, you know, that's just not okay. We got to be able to be better than that. And we're losing a lot of valuable points this season in a hurry. Won the first three races and took advantage of some misfortunes of McGill. And now we're headed on the downhill. So we got to turn this thing around.
You know, that's really odd, you know, the mood that Walker was in. I think that was filmed yesterday afternoon. Now, I talked to Walker last night, and his spirits really seemed to be picked up a lot more than what we were seeing right there. I don't know if he just came out of a nap, out of a sleepy Benadryl phase, or whatever was going on there. But, yeah, he didn't seem to be real excited right there at that particular moment. But last night when I talked to him about 8 o'clock, he was your upbeat, chipper, Walker Fowler. I mean, he was joking and laughing and carrying on. So, you know, as down as he may have seemed during that interview, don't let that fool you, because he's not riding with that kind of an attitude at all. He's on fire right now.
No, I think, you know, he's noticed that his big lead that he did have, he's seen it slip away, and he knows the urgency of he's got to make a statement today. And really, yeah, he sounded like he was down there, but he was just speaking the truth. You know,
yeah.
He's like, hey, it's over. I got to make this happen. I got to start getting the points to go the other way, because when we're raced like that, and all, you know, it's 2-point difference now. So I got to start going the other way to try to make things
and, you know,
in my court.
He pointed out, I don't know, man. I mean, you think about it. He says, you know, he's been running a good championship season. There's no doubt about it. He's been running consistently. The only bad thing about the consistency that he's seen is that he's been being beaten consistently by the same guy week after week. If it was a different winner up front, it wouldn't be as big a deal. But since it's the same guy, it's making it a little bit tougher. So I think he knows what he's got to do. He's ready for the long haul, as is, I believe, Adam McGill at this particular point. He's been in this position the last 3 years a couple different times. So I think he's learned a lot over the course of the last few years. And I think that Adam's going to be in it a lot more and a lot longer, and maybe right down to the very, very end in the 2016 championship run.
And that's what's neat about the way the GNCC point system is, Rodney. You know, even though Walker's been consistent all year long, he's still losing points to the guy that wins the race, gets 5 extra points. So the guy that's winning gets rewarded, and that's what makes this racing so cool, because even if you have a couple bad races, you can go out there and win 3 or 4 in a row, and you can get yourself right back in the game. And that's exactly what Adam McGill's done so far this year. He's right back in the game where Walker Fowler had that big lead. Well, that big lead is almost gone.
It is, you know, it's time now. I mean, just because he's there doesn't mean he's going to be able to take a lead. We're going through the pro pits right now. Now we're down to like 4 to 5 seconds, it looks like. That gap is now closed in half again, from 39 seconds down to 9 seconds, now down to about 4 to 5 seconds. You see the crowd running over toward the finish line. They want to see what's going to happen when these guys hit the moto track. When they hit the moto track, it's going to be on. Both these guys have got some good moto skills out there, Brad.
Yeah, Rodney, I don't think Walker Fowler or Adam McGill is going to have an upper hand on this motocross section. Both these guys are doing the double jumps, they're doing the double uphills, and they're going through the corners as fast as they can go. Right now, you know, we're coming to the one lap, the white flag, so this is it. Walker Fowler's either got to put his head down and get going, or Adam McGill's going to be right on his fender here shortly.
Well, we'll take a look at the rest of the field in just a moment, soon as these guys check in with lap number 3 complete in the XC1 Pro class. We are watching Walker Fowler lead this one through the moto track on the uphill stair steps now. Kind of reminiscent of the old Steel City Raceway there, only going to the right instead of the left that they did there at Steel City. But I always like that section, jump section there. Over the double doubles now into the finish line reach. It looks like Walker Fowler is running uncontestedly right now, but I think you look just a little bit further back as he takes that white flag. We're going to see that 521 also taking that white flag. And now the gap, 5.4 seconds. The lap time, 26.19 for Fowler, 26.15 for Adam McGill. In theory right now, these guys should be nose to tail, actually side by side. This could be a photo finish whenever they come down to it in the next 26 and a half minutes or so. It's going to get pretty doggone interesting, I think.
Yes, it is, right? And you can see that Danny Fowler, Walker's dad, was there right before the finish line giving him that water bottle, and he still has that water bottle in his mouth. So Walker Fowler's doing the right thing right now. He's getting some more fluid in him, getting some more up, and he's looking over his shoulder to see if Adam McGill's catching him. But right now, you've got to keep the fluids in, and he's got that water in his mouth right now. He's going to drink all that, and he's going to let it fall out. But, man, he's got to get going because Adam McGill's coming after him.
No doubt, you know, and Walker even making a statement. He says he's not making any excuses, but since that crash, I believe, at Big Buck, he's been suffering with some issues. He said he was a little banged up after that, didn't say a whole lot to anybody about it, but he says he's even got some other issues that I don't know that were necessarily linked to that, but he has certainly had his work cut out for him to try and maintain at least second place the way it sounds. Now look at this battle right now on the moto track. The champ, the former champ, I should say, of Chris Borch, all over the rear wheels of the Bullet right now, as he is trying to wet the gunpowder of this young man and heading toward the finish line. Look at this side-by-side, and I think that that Chris Borch is going to go for the pass and try to move into the number three spot. What's the gap like between second and third right now? That is a big question. A minute and 37 seconds. That's down from a minute and 1 second. So these guys really, man, they're paced so much slower than what we're seeing Fowler and McGill's pace at right now, amazingly. And the gap, 0.4 of a second between Neal and Borch there at the finish line. What happened to Cole Richardson, I guess, is a big question. He has not checked in yet in that number five spot.
But looks like here he comes right now, Rodney. He's kind of looking over whether he's having bike problems or I'm not sure what's going on, but he said something to his pit crew right there before he came to the finish line. And
yeah, that's not good news for Cole Richardson, the 7:33. Cold train may be overheating. They might have piped up the steam engine a little bit too much out there on it.
Yeah, you're right. That could have happened. It could have really happened easily on a day like today. But right now, Chris Borch, he's finding that he's ready to make that patented Borch pounce here on this last lap.
Yeah, he is. And he's got the young Bryson Neal right in his sights set for that one. Jay Shadron should be checking in here soon. Whether or not he'll be able to get the best of the 7:33 of Cole Richardson, that question remains to be answered. But he's really not far off the pace right now. Actually, that was Landon Wolf checking in the number six spot. Sorry about that, Landon. LW. The number nine is Jay Shadron checking in seventh place. So Wolf is now sixth. 3 seconds behind him is Jay Shadron. Jared McClure was running eighth. Here's the interesting thing. Greg Covert again, the XC2 Pro-Am, your leader. Ninth overall, Devin Feehan, College A. Leader, 10th overall. That is something I want to keep an eye on here in this final lap as these guys will be approaching here in just a moment. Well, Fred, I tell you, I'm going to take this moment to update everyone on the entire field of riders and classes. I should say not the entire field of riders, but classes. The XC1 Pros, we told you, Fowler, McGill, Neal, Borch, Richardson, Wolf in sixth. That's Landon, Jay Shadron in seventh, Jared McClure is eighth, Tucker Wyatt ninth, Josh Merritt rounding out the top 10. Johnny Gallagher, after an extended pit stop, is in 11th spot. The XC2 Pro-Am class, Greg Covert, Wesley Wolf, a minute and 25 seconds separating the two. Randy Hamilton back in number three spot. James Green, the 22, is fourth. Kevin Yoho in fifth. Levi Cohen in sixth. Marty Christopherson in seventh. Matthew Lindell is eighth. Bryson Hobbs, the 223, in ninth. And Kenny Schick rounds out your top 10 aboard the number 23. Now to the College A class. Windsor, New York's Devin Feehan, the 33, who's running 10th overall, 54 seconds flat ahead of the 318 of Hunter Hart out there out of Newfield, New York. Zachary Jones, the 720 out of North Augusta, South Carolina, running in the number three spot. Fourth place, the 217, Drew Landers out of Monterey, Tennessee, and rounding out in the top five, the 768 of Tyler Wares out of Marietta, Ohio. That's after two laps of racing complete. The tightest battle there was between the third and fourth place ride, Zachary Jones and Drew Landers, I should say, as there was only 4 seconds separating them. And there's what you could win today, folks, if you GNCC Live it on Instagram and you hashtag it, event t-shirt featuring Josh Merritt, the number 14 there. So Instagram a photo of how you're watching GNCC Live for a chance to win that, my friends. So we go next to the Junior A class, Jeff Miller, the 533 from Summersville, West Virginia, leading 28 seconds over Stevie Covert, the 29 out of Ithaca, New York. Josh Konacek is running in the number three spot aboard the 936 of the Vivella PA. Nick Mastrangelo, the 77 out of Newcastle PA, is fourth. And Brett Cover, the 404 out of Beaver Falls PA. Now I think Mastrangelo is actually a ATV motocross racer as well, if I'm not mistaken. I always struggle with his name at the ATV. I know he was there last week, the last couple of rounds anyway. But here we go to the Vet A class. Dustin Hendershot from Washington, West Virginia. Welcome back, old Dusty. Tommy Coots, or AJ, as we know him by, the number 30 out of Fayetteville, Pennsylvania, is running in second.
Big Papa P.
Jeff Pickens, the number 98 out of Shamokin, Pennsylvania, running in third. Bam! Joey Margary, the 788, is fourth out of Avella, PA. And Adam Reed out of Beelsville, Ohio, the 870, rounds out the top five. It's pretty amazing when your vet class has as many stars in it just about as what the pro class, the pro-am class does nowadays, man. That's pretty cool that we're seeing a lot of those guys return into some of those
other
races.
Well, that shows you, Rodney. Everybody likes, you know, GNCC racing. Once you get GNCC racing in your blood, you don't want to give it up. So even if you got to come back in a different class, people are still coming back. And here we are right now with third and fourth place. Will it be
Borch get him?
Nope.
Bryson sure
Neal still with Borch still hot on his tail.
Well, they continue that battle. We'll watch that one. Wade John, we're out near the 2 mile marker looking at the senior 8 B38 Fuzz class now. Will we watch the battle for third on this final lap? We got Rusty Repass leading the senior AB 38 plus class out of Mooresville, North Carolina, with a 42nd lead over Rob Zimmerman, the 227. Third place, the 636 of Mark Batson out of LaSalle, Michigan. Fourth place, the 860 Mike Muskop out of Trenton, Ohio. And fifth place, the 129 Jeff Range from Barnhart, Missouri. Looking next at the College B class, Shane Pitzer leading Joseph Erickson. Pitzer on the 347 from Fobble, PA, out of Champion, PA, a minute 9 seconds back. In second is the 328 of Erickson. Eli Kiger, teammate to the number 9 of Bryson Neal, the 808 out of Waynesburg, Pennsylvania, 49 seconds back in third. Frankie Gress, the 420 out of Rachel, West Virginia, is fourth. And fifth place, Michael Anderson out of Cloverdale, Indiana, in that College B class. That looks like a good battle going on there in some of those positions. Ryan Bovis, I believe he got the hole shot in this junior B class out of Chepachet, Rhode Island, on the 840 in the junior B 22 plus class. He has a 46 second lead over the 330 of Charles Dawson out of Lisbon, Ohio. Third spot, the 155 of Chris Ballew from Leoma, Tennessee. Fourth place, the 61 of Brian Felicki out of Poland, Ohio. And fifth spot, David Kite, 321 out of Northeast Maryland. By the way, folks, while we look at these classes, we do want to welcome the WEXCR, or Wexer. It is a southeastern Ohio-based off-road series, similar to the GNCC. It's kind of a mini mock-up model of that. Races on the off weekends. So this weekend, they're in conjunction with us. We're getting dual points, GNCC points and Wexer points this weekend. Hey, Corey Blinkowitz leading the the Vet B class on these ATV Saturday. Elwood City, PA, where he's from. Dale Batson, the 671 out of Ida, Michigan, who got the hole shot in the class in second. About 25 seconds back now. Aaron Hendershot, 120 out of Spring Valley, Ohio, is third. Philip Thayer, the 102 from Imperial, Missouri, is fourth. And 119, Jason Dillard out of Charleston, West Virginia. Speaking of Missouri, I saw a old Missouri boy with us there just a little bit ago. Slipped my mind. It's not Cook, but it's the other Brian that we have. Page. Brian Page out there with us. Good to see he is back here. Got his son out to race with him. They weren't racing, but they were watching. By the way, that is a look at your Vet B 30 Plus class. By the way, Brian, you can come back and race the Vet class as well. We see Jeff Pickens out there and a few other guys. We'd love to have you back. But that is a look at our leaders in our top five in all of our classes here after two laps of racing complete. You can call that the Midway Report. Now, we are a little further than Midway on the clock as we are an hour and 29 minutes now into this race at Fred Andrews, along with myself, Rodney Tomlin, of course, Megawatt Matt Watson out giving us some call. He's got the good job right now.
Yeah, I noticed that.
I want Megawatt's job.
Well, here you go, Rodney. We were talking about earlier, these guys are making new lines. There's must be somebody hung up somewhere on this little shale section right here in the Rocky Mountain, Rocky River. And I think our leader should be coming by here pretty soon.
That was. Wow, that was hard to even see. That's how mud. Now, we look at this course and say, it's not a lot of mud. You think nice, sunshiny day. Man, we had a lot of rain leading into this. The pits were very soft, man, very deceiving. So is the track. You can see there's a lot of moisture out there in the woods. And you can also see low-lying areas, creeks and stuff like that, carrying a lot of water. And we're getting a lot of water splash up, a lot of mud splashing up, making those guys a little tougher to determine out there on the track.
Yeah, and like we said earlier, it's not getting any deeper because this is all shale and all rock, but sometimes the guys get stuck on it. And like you saw, the leaders, I believe that was, they went off to the right, and they were making their own line to go around these guys to make things happen, because this is when stuff happens on the last lap. You know, you kind of think you got it going on, you got it going good, and boom, when something happens as quickly as this, these guys got to make the right decision, and it looks like both the guys made a good decision and made it through there without trouble. So it still looks like Walker Fowler is in the lead with Adam McGill, you know, right there on his heels.
Now leaders do in about 15 and a half minutes at this point. Fred Andrews, Fowler and McGill, last check, 5.4 seconds separated the two. We saw McGill make up some 30 seconds on one lap, another 4.5 seconds, or about 4.5 seconds on the next lap. He has been turning consistently a little bit faster lap times, 26:15 last time to Fowler's 26:19. So we are certainly in store for something big taking place here. There is the battle for the number 3 spot. Looks like still Bryson Neal. These guys are closer to 2 minutes back now, a minute 37 seconds at the finish line, but I'd say we're closer to 2 minutes at this point. But they're still battling back there for the number three spot, but it looks like Bryson pretty much has that one dialed in at the moment.
Yeah, you know what? Sorry, Walker fella. Chris Borch is doing what he can. He's keeping himself right where he needs to be. If Bryson Neal makes a mistake, you know, Chris Borch is going to try to make that pounce. But, you know, Bryson Neal right now, he's in third place, and he's not going to want to give that up to Chris Borch. So whatever it takes, if he's got to get a little bit wide on the track, he's going to get a little bit wide. And right now, here comes our leaders. Uh-oh.
Is that
McGill leading? Did we miss Walker Fowler?
I don't know if he was leading or not, but we just saw McGill going through the 4 mile marker. Let's double check this. We may have missed on our camera shot the number one of Walker Fowler.
Yeah, so we did miss him. The camera just set up. There comes the leaders, and we did miss Walker Fowler. So he is leading.
Wow, that got my heart.
So they can relax a little bit down there, Mark Notman and crew. Your guy's still in the lead, but Adam McGill is pushing it.
Wow, he is.
About winning today. He's going to try to take that win away from the Ohio boy.
No doubt. Man, and at that point, I mean, come on. 7 rounds in, like I said, this is the pinnacle halfway point of this race, of this championship. Pull within, well, if Walker was to hold on to second and Adam get the win, pull within 2 points heading into the next couple of rounds. Wow, that would really be probably the tightest, most contested championship we've seen at this point. We've seen it tight before, and we've seen the points change around, but man, to see it like this is, I don't even know that in 14 that Walker Fowler saw even slipping up and he gained quite like this, but it's getting interesting, that's for sure.
You know, right in our next race is that snowshoe. So snowshoe's typically one of those races that it throws a lot at you. So there's a lot of things that could take you out of the race. Where this race here, you know, this is a rider race. They got to make it happen. And when you go to snowshoe, the next round, if you can win here, that's going to be some serious momentum going into snowshoe. Because snowshoe, you kind of got to be careful, take your time, because there's a lot of rocks, and a lot of really tough sections that can take you out.
When do we go to New York for the Tomahawk? I keep thinking that we got to go to Tomahawk. We do go to Tomahawk next. Then it's
snowshoe. Right? Oh, sorry, it's snowshoe end of month. So, okay.
Yeah,
fine.
Well, I may be wrong.
No, I think you're right.
Yeah, because I kept thinking that Tomahawk was this weekend, and then that John Penton was the next, and then snowshoe. So we actually changed things up just a little bit there.
And the Tomahawk last year, man, we had a great race there. That was a great new facility that we went to with all those big open fields. And it had a lot of little rock sections like here in Millfield also.
Yeah.
And you can see a couple guys right now getting towed in from the GNCC crew.
Yeah. And that's just off the beaten path right there. You're getting a little off the beaten path. You can see that it has got its challenges out there. Look at those roots and those rocks. I mean, honestly, we talk about this is your typical GNCC trail. It offers a little bit of everything. This track really does. I mean, it does. I mean, we don't have the mountains. We do have hill climbs, but we don't have the snowshoe mountains. We don't have the monstrous rocks that we have in boulders, but we've got rocks. We've got creek crossings. We've got mud. We got loam. We've got hard-packed clay. We've got open fields, and we got motocross tracks.
Yeah, Ronnie, we do have it all. We do have the big rocks, but these guys, as you can see, they're picking, choosing their way around them, because any one of these big rocks, they could hit with their sprocket and throw a chain or hit and bend a disc or even grab an A-arm. So you have to be on your toes at all times here at the John Penn.
For sure, for sure. The oldest race on the tour here, second to only Loretta Lynn's, which is no longer on this championship schedule right now. Not saying that it won't come back. I know that that is something that they're looking for in the future, but wanted to give it a little bit of a break for just a little while to get that prestige back maybe again one day and give the riders and fans something to look forward to when we do finally make that return back to that illustrious facility. You know what's funny, though, is, you know, as big as Loretta Lynn's is, GNCC was about to outgrow Loretta Lynn's, believe it or not. It always blew me away.
Yes, it sure was. You know, and talk about this being the John Penton. You know, John Penton's not only started it and brought Pentons over to America, which now turned into like the KTMs. You know, he was kind of the founder and said, hey, from me talking with him, with Mr. Penton, he said, you know, hey, I went to them and said, hey, can you make me these kind of bikes? And he made the bikes and he called them a Penton. And then KTM kind of saw what he was doing, so they started making bikes and then they started selling more. But he was also in High Point, which I'm not sure a lot of people know. Back in the day, they make High Point trailers, which you still see some coming around. They were all fiberglass. I mean, they made tires, and he made oils, and the Penton family, they really had a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah, they did. It's amazing how instrumental they were in the off-road racing world. I mean, if you think about it, they revolutionized what off-road racing was. They set a standard for off-road racing, and they gave basically the model machine that these people were going to have to build in order to be competitive in the off-road racing world. And basically what the scientists did with that, it was took the best idea that was available, and they've tried to improve on John Pitton's invention. And man, they have come a long, long way with the off-road machines like the KTMs. Just amazing what they've been able to do. I mean, so many years ago, starting out as a Penton motorcycle, now as a KTM, just they've really done their homework, that's for sure. And John Penton, believe it or not, a living legend, will be here tomorrow celebrating KTM Youth Day with the youth riders there. Amazing what he's still with us and the impact that he's had in our sport.
You know, and we needed a better boot. So he went to Italy and he went to a person and said, hey, can you make me this boot? And they made that boot, and that boot's Alpine Star now, you know? He went there with what he wanted, and they took off that, and they made a little bit, changed a few things. And I mean, John Penton has started a lot of bikes and gear and different stuff that he's not really getting credit for. Yeah, and like you said, the red dot tire. He had a tire, he had an oil, he did it all. Whatever it took for racing, John Penton had it made or made it himself to make it with standards that he thought it needed to be. And a lot of that stuff is carried over today under different brands. He's got a lot of companies started.
Made a lot of people some good college educations for their kids, I guess. College funds, I guess.
Yeah, even
kids.
A plastic company that's going today, that's one of the biggest ones ever. You know, I think when I was talking with John Penton about this, he helped start that company. He said, hey, make me this. And they saw a niche that, hey, a lot of motorcycle people like that. Well, let's start making them for other brands. And next thing you know, now they're one of the biggest, if not the biggest, plastic company out there.
Wow, that's crazy, man. That's amazing what that man has done. And if you're anywhere near Ohio, we encourage you to come over, be a part of it. If you can't be here today, come over for tomorrow. Tomorrow's the big bike day, and that's when a lot of the celebrations for, of course, that will be taking place. John Penton will be here. We'll be celebrating the retirement of Charlie Mullins as well, as he'll be saying farewell to GNCC, a former two-wheel champion. But, man, what a big weekend as far as John Penton GNCC is concerned. And right now, we're continuing to wrap it up out here as our leaders, believe it or not, due in less than 7 minutes now at this point, I believe, according to timing and scoring. Actually, just over seven. But regardless, they are rolling this way pretty hard and pretty quick. And we should be getting a bit of an update on these guys. And speaking of updates, I'm going to... So we're going to get this update. Track crew, this is Rodney again here on Racer TV, just checking in to see what kind of changes, if any, are going on out here.
Rodney, I don't know what happened between the 2 and the 4. I don't know if you guys got it on film or anything, but McGillan dropped back. I'm waiting on him at the 7. He's about 20 seconds back. He won't really be able to do that.
Oh, well, 10-4, thank you very much, Jeff. So we got the report now that Adam McGill has dropped back 20 seconds, I think, is what Jeff Russell just told us there. So for the McGill Mafia, that's a little bit of a letdown, I think, especially after what we saw him able to accomplish. But again, here we are late in the race. Sound like a broken record, but there's more lap traffic that these riders have got to contend with here. So that 20 seconds, depending on what lies between there and the finish line, might be easily made up, and could still see the face of the race change. But man, this late in the race, the war of attrition is really starting to set in right now. I almost have to think that this might be par for the course right now. And riders, and even Adam McGill, might be thinking, okay, it's time, instead of pushing it and really taking myself out of this, let's go ahead and give Walker this win, let him get that advantage again, feel a little more comfortable, we'll try to come back and do it again in 2 weeks.
Or, you know, Adam McGill could also have been pushing as he was, as hard as he's been all day long. He could have made that one mistake and almost got off big time, and now he could be saying, whoa, I better just, you know, settle for second, get some points, you know, and then there's another race coming.
Right.
Or he could have caught a lapper. You know, a lot of things could happen. But I think if Adam McGill came to getting a big get off or something and he lost that time, he may just said, okay, like race is almost over. Let's just take what we can get and go on from there.
Well, it wouldn't surprise me to hear him say that I caught up to Walker, was going for the pass, and almost crashed, lost a bunch of time, or I got ahead of him and got stuck behind it. It wouldn't be surprising me to hear that. I mean, because he was within striking distance. There was no doubt about it. Time will tell. I mean, we'll hear the story, I'm sure, on the podium if Adam's able to keep it up there in position. Though right now we still continue to wonder what's going on with third place. I mean, there's some now 2 minutes behind first and second place. Bryson Neal steady there in third. Chris Borch at one point was actually pushing. Just getting a report. McGill broke down between the four and the seven, and I got to tell you, this is not what he needs. Not now. Not now. Not for Adam McGill. He does not need this now. This is the worst thing that could happen, and I didn't want to jinx him and bring it up, man, but these are the types of things that have really come into play as far as his bid for the championship the last 2 years, now make it 3 years in a row. If you remember, he was well within the hunt and thick of things in 2014, making it a three-man shootout at the Unidilogy NCC. He had a DNF there that took him way back in points, and that took him out of the hunt for the championship. Last year, same thing about the midway point or so. Big problem taking place, taking him out of the thick and really giving Walker a little bit of breathing room that he needed to carry that championship on home. And this might be, man, it may be deja vu again, man. If Adam has broke down, he could lose a lot of points today. And we were even talking about that. Only the top 20 score points. And it's not a matter of just losing 10, 15, or 20 points. We're going to see a total of 30 points likely lost between first and second place, or 25 points anyway. I think, what's it go, 30 or 25 points on the win? I think it's 30, then 25, then 22. So that would be a total of 30 points if he does not score into the top 20 that he would lose. And then that gap that was 7 points now all of a sudden becomes 37 points. And the face of the championship has changed yet again. And Walker Fowler looks like he's got an easy skate through the second half of the season. But then, man, I think the Beaver's going to really come alive back behind him in that second place position in that battle for points back there. Because, I mean, you got Bryson Neal. He's going to be hungry for number two in points. Chris Borch is going to be hungry for that. And Adam's going to be fighting tooth and nail with everything he has to not only gain back second, but try to catch up to Walker Fowler, because he knows it only takes one bad race also for Walker to even that playing field back out. And Walker knows that as well as anyone as well, because he's seen it happen whenever he was battling for championships against Chris Borch.
Yeah, right. You're 100% right. It, you know, unfortunate for Adam McGill to have bad luck like this on the last lap when he was putting in such a great ride. But is this season over? No. I mean, he's going to have to come back. He's going to have to regroup, and he's going to have to start winning races, because you're right. Walker Fowler could have trouble. Bryson Neal, Chris Forrest, any of these guys could have trouble at any given race, and that could put him right back in the game. But also, if he starts clicking off some wins, there's 5 points, 5 points, 5 points. Right now, here comes Walker Fowler to the finish line. Here's Mark Notman giving him the board, telling him that Adam McGill is out. You got the motocross track to go, buddy. Cruise it on in. Let's take this win, and let's get these points, and let's go home and look forward to the next race.
There you go. So we're not real sure where Adam is and how he's going to finish, but right now it's looking rather dismal for him. It's Walker Fowler on a victory lap, so to speak, as he gets set to head to the Moto Track here in Ohio, ready to make it three consecutive wins here in the great state of Ohio at the John Penton GNCC. He's looking to make four wins here in the 2016 championship season. A little further look back in the pack, setting the stage for you. College A leader is now eighth place overall. Devin Feehan is ahead on time adjustment of the XC2 Pro-Am class leader, which happens to be Greg Covert, the number 21, who is back in the number 9 position. That's interesting. That's something we definitely got to get some words with that guy, I think, before the next race to find out what he has done that is so special. But that's how things are starting to shape up there. Covert, Wesley Wolf is second in the XC2 Pro-Am. Kevin Yoho is up to third. But right now, as we motor through the moto track, here comes Ohio's own Fowler Fanatics as he gets set to capture the checkers here in 2016 for his second bid for the title. As he makes that final turn, the drive up the hill and crossing the finish line, as Walker Fowler, four wins in 2016, and stretches the points lead out here at the Wiseco John Penton GNCC, as he is in the books for another win and also one step closer to championship title number two. Talk about a big sigh of relief, Brett Andrews. That right there has to be the biggest sigh of relief that he was able to take so far this championship season. And the sigh of relief does not come until round seven, the exact midway point of 2016.
Yeah, I think he really looks forward to this event. Like you say, he did his homework. He's in Ohio. We all expected him to win. I know I sure did, and he's done it. Was it easy? Heck no, it wasn't easy. Adam McGill was breathing down his neck. He had that big lead. Adam McGill reeled him in. I'm sure that got in Walker's head a little bit. He was starting to think about it. But, hey, he did what he came here to do. He won the event. Adam McGill was unfortunate. He had some bad luck. And right now there's his dad and Mark Notman are congratulating him on his win. He's having a little bit of water. He's got a little smile on his face. He looks a little bit different than he did yesterday in that interview. And interesting thing is going to be second and third right now.
Yeah,
Bryson Neal and Chris Borch. These guys are going to get the pit board probably in the pit area saying, hey, you're second and you're third. And they're going to say, what? And they're going to really spark them up for this last little bit to the run to the finish.
Oh, yeah. It's really going to make it interesting, as you say, the run to the finish. The battle for the number two and three spots overall. Now to the Bidwell Bullet of Bryson Neal and Chris Borch. The bandit himself sitting in wait, ready to lay chase and try to take that position in the final and closing moments here on this motor
track. And here they are, Rodney, right now, I believe. It still looks like it's Bryson Neal with Chris Borch right on his tail.
Well, right here, I'll tell you a lot of what kind of confidence Bryson Neal is riding with as Chris Borch is all over his rear wheel. The veteran of Chris Borch pulling up side by side
he's
going
to stick it in right here, Rodney. There it is. He gave him the inside.
Borch, what a beautiful
Borch puts the move on the inside, but Bryson Neal's not done.
Bryson Neal firing back. It's a drag race to the final turns right now. Here comes Borch. He's got the inside, but Neal back at it again. Whoa, who's he going to be at the checkers? I think that Chris Borch may have just inched ahead as they roll across the finish line, and Chris Borch takes the number two position here in Ohio. Let me double check that. Yes, it was Borch. 2 minutes, 22 seconds behind Walker Fowler for second as Bryson Neal was finished up in the number three spot. 0.843 behind, less than a second back there for that battle for second, and no sign of Adam McGill. Man, what a heartbreaker for the Mafia right now. You got to think right now there's a Mafia chain about a mile long that is just trying to take turns and getting that guy to the finish line right now. But I think the damage is done, man. I think that he's out of this one. And, well, we still may see it happen, but it's not looking so good right now. And I'm telling you, again, remember, if he does not score top 20, that's going to add another 30 points onto that, and that gap of seven all of a sudden becomes 37.
Man, how about that finish, Rodney? You couldn't have told me that those two guys would almost, I mean, the second place almost switched, three or four times those guys coming around that motocross track. It's amazing. Bryson just left Chris Borch just a little bit of room on the inside, and Chris knew from the experience to get his wheel up in there and pushed him wide, then Bryson Neal high-loading, almost passed him back. Man, that was awesome racing coming to the finish line.
Yes, it was. Look at Chris Borch. You can tell he's pretty stoked that he got the second-place position, and that was a fun finish for him. But he knows the real tale of the tape with Walker Fowler up front. But yet, Borch yet another step closer, another feather in the cap, and obviously positive things happening in the points. Oh, wait a minute. Live timing and scoring, folks. We must have gotten some bad reports or Adam McGill got that machine fired back up, Fred Andrews, because right now, look at timing and scoring. Adam McGill has checked in 22 seconds behind that battle for second place, so I don't know what happened. That's almost like 3 minutes, 2.5 minutes that whatever time that he lost out there, he lost, but he was able to get it fired back up. And now all of a sudden that championship doesn't seem so bleak for Adam McGill. We were talking if he finished out of the top 20, which from all indications, that's what we were thinking was going to happen there, Fred. But he gets fourth place, so all of a sudden the gap not as bad as what it was looking like it was going to be. And Adam McGill still in the hunt for this championship in 2016. He may be a little further behind the eight ball, but listen, we still got six rounds of racing to go.
Yeah, Rodney, you know, like you said, if it would have happened, he would have DNF'd, he would have lost 30-some points. Well, now he's probably lost maybe 10, 11, so that's not such a big deal to him He's been winning races and wins a couple. Right there goes, you know, 5 points win over second place. So if he did have bike trouble, or maybe he'd got off, you know, we don't really don't know for sure if he was trying to get catch Walker, if he hooked something and crashed real hard and got himself going again, or what happened. So it'd be interesting to see what happened to him on the last lap. But either way,
maybe we can get someone.
You know, we were talking to worst case scenario, and here he comes in fourth place. So,
right.
Man, big sigh of relief for the Mafia
there. We were talking worst case scenario, and I am very satisfied for Adam McGill that that is not the case. And I don't know where Megawatt is. Maybe he can snag Adam to get a word in with him to see what happened there before we head to the podium. But there's a couple of other interesting things taking place there as Jacob Beck gets us ready for our next shot on top of the big pole over there. Fowler taking the win, Boric in second, Neal in third, fourth is McGill, Landon Wolf, check it out, LW rounding out the top five. We're looking for Shadron, he finishes sixth place, Cole Richardson was seventh, Devin Feehan, we expect to check in the eighth place position, that is your College A class leader, and he actually has a better time than the XC2 Pro-Am class. We'll try to update you on that and more when GNCC Live returns to Victory Circle right after this.
When it comes to protecting your engine, AMSOIL offers the next level performance truck owners demand. AMSOIL provides 75% more engine protection against horsepower loss and wear than required by a leading industry standard, extending the life of pistons and cams. Give the vehicle you love the above and beyond fortification it deserves. AMSOIL, devoted to protection. Maxxis Tires.
Here at Rocky Mountain ATV MC, our goal has always been to get you the best price and provide quality service. Now, we're giving you one more reason to shop with Rocky Mountain. We call it Quick Cash. It's simple to get. Just place an order with a qualifying Quick Cash item and get cash to spend on your next order. Try it out today. RockyMountainATVMC.com. Get ready.
The Andersons discovered life is easier with an Outlaw RV. The Outlaw is a complete home on wheels with a multifunctional garage. Getting on the road has never been quicker. The Outlaw is made to fit the lifestyle of today's active families. So stop roughing it and start enjoying your weekends. Find the Thor Motor Coach Outlaw that fits your needs at GarageRVs.com today.
I'm a sore loser.
I'm a sore loser.
Losing is not an option for me.
Be the best.
The best.
The best.
You have to have the best equipment under the hood.
That's why I
only use
Kometic products in my engines.
Kometic gasket.
Kometic gasket.
Kometic gasket.
Kometic gasket, a superior quality gasket
for those of us who demand the highest level of performance.
And welcome back to GNCC Live as we check out some great photos from around the area. We're in Millfield, but nearby is Athens, Ohio, home to Ohio University. Athens, Ohio University is well noted as one of the nation's premier colleges, as well as alma mater to Matt Lauer from the Today Show, and also Jay Leno, formerly of the Tonight Show, just to name a few. The Ohio Bobcats is an avid football and basketball community, and folks, let me tell you, they take their partying serious there, too, known as one of the top partying schools in the nation. They have the annual Halloween Block Party, which is a massive international spectacle that draws tens of thousands of people from across the world, news media, and everyone, in to see what happens there. As it is also known as one of the 10 most haunted American cities, believe it or not. And it's pretty eerie. You look at it, it looks like a big pinnacle if you look at it from the sky from the original city layout. But regardless, here we are at the Ironman. Our AMSOIL Twitter contest winner is Brittany Stiverson at B. Stiverson, BL Stiverson. Podium predictions, Fowler, McGill, and Borge. Hashtag GMCC Live. Hashtag podium prediction. Congratulations to Brandy Stiverson on your win in the AMSOIL Twitter contest. You'll pick yourself up $250 in sweet, sweet AMSOIL products here. And our Instagram winner, here we go. That is flying Ryan Eccles. Ryan Eccles, 345, watching. He's watching the Camp Coker on NBC and watching Racer TV live online. So, Ryan, glad to have you out here and watching, flying around 345. We say congratulations to him. He's certainly having some fun, and we'll get Ryan an event T-shirt from Moto T's Event Souvenirs. Wow. All right, you know, looking at this again, Fowler, Borge, Neal, that's your top three. McGill gets fourth. Wolf in fifth, Shad's on his sixth. 21 of Greg Covert. He's your XC2 Pro-Am winner. He'll take seventh at least right now. Wesley Wolf was 23 seconds. He made up a minute on him into the eighth place position. And Devin Feehan holds on for ninth place overall. He is your College A class winner. He gets he does get beat by the XC2 guys, but still a top 10 for a College A rider. And Josh Merritt, featured on the event T-shirt, will round out the top 10 overall. I think my results are different than what we're seeing there on the board. But regardless, Hunter Hart just checked in 10th place. See, that's changing constantly is why that was different. So Hunter Hart is now 10th overall behind Devin Feehan. He's about 44 seconds behind him. So, man, I tell you, you got to give it up to the amateurs today, as they did extremely well here in the heat of Ohio. And, again, Fred, I mean, taking into consideration that, that's probably been one of the biggest obstacles. Even though we didn't see a lot of riders falling out, you can't say that this guy got tired, that guy did this or made a mistake because of that. The humidity definitely played, and the heat played a definite role, I think, in the outcome of this race, because it made for riders not being able to push maybe as long as they normally do, and that's maybe why we saw some of those bigger gaps that we're not accustomed to here today.
Yeah, that too, Ronnie, and I also think that our College A guys and our other guys are taking the racing more serious, that they're getting themselves in the top 10.
Yeah.
Usually we're not seeing these guys at tougher races that are real hot or like this, but these guys are all taking it because they want to win just as bad as the guys in the XC1 class. That's where they want to be someday, and they're all keeping themselves fit and getting in better shape, and they're getting themselves in the top 10. So my hat's off to all those guys too, because it's not easy getting the top 10 in a GNCC race.
Oh, no, it is not.
Especially when you start that far back. And these guys got a lot of guys to pass and a lot of stuff going on back there and a lot of confusion happen.
I think they started at least third or fourth row back there. And like you say, I mean, it makes it tougher the farther back you start. And that makes it even more impressive when they do make a top 10 like that. So, but Devin Feehan and Hunter Hart, man, those two going at it. There's Bryson Neal making his way up to the podium right now. Walker Fowler up on the podium, man. You can hear the machines revving up. How about it for that guy right there?
Chris Old Yeller.
Borge. Old Yeller and Chris Borge making their way to the podium. How about it, Ohio? Put your hands together for a top three overall. Bryson Neal in third, Chris Borge in second, and your Ohio champion, Ohio's own Walker Fowler. Heading on down to Megawatt, Matt Watson, who's standing by at Victory Lane.
Hey, thank you guys so much. Appreciate it, Rodney. Hey, Sunday Creek, let's make some noise for these guys right here, and I mean, let's hear it. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Hey, let's get our riders up here in the front. Let's get our class picture taken real quick. See if we can get some of this turned down a little bit, Rodney. We got a bad vibration down here. If we could get that turned down just a bit, thank you. Perfect. Well, a little bit more. Turn it down just a bit, guys. All right, we still got a buzz going on. All right, hey, guys, can we get the level turned down just a bit? All right, think we got it now? Maybe not. All right, we're going to try it one more time here. All right, we'll see if this helps just a bit. A little bit? All right, that working better? Perfect, you guys. Good deal. Good deal. Hey, one more time, Sunday Creek. Let me hear it for these guys up here. And I mean, make some noise. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Hey, third place here right now, Bryson Neal. Bryson, unbelievable turn of events out there. Let me tell you something. You got this thing going. When you drop the hammer, you never let off the rest of the day, man. When you drop that clutch, it was full throttle the rest of the day. Tell us a little bit about that ride.
Starting frontwards would have been a little bit easier myself, but I looked at it like a challenge. So, I mean, these past 2 weeks, I've been training like crazy. I told myself as soon as that green flag drops, as soon as I hit that throttle, every second, every corner counts. And I actually caught the front leaders about 7 miles into the track, and man, I pushed really hard, and man, these fans out here today, they were amazing. Everyone out there cheering, pointing lines. There's so many people out there. I mean, it's just a great experience racing down to the finish for Chris Borge. I mean, it don't get any better than that. That's fun. That's pure adrenaline. That's what racing's all about.
I know one thing. You look like you had another two laps left in you when you come off the track, man. The heat didn't bother you at all today, it didn't look like.
Yeah, if we had a three-hour race instead of a two-hour race, I think I could have pulled it off. I'm in pretty good shape. But, today it's hot. I can't wait to I want to go jump in the pond, actually, cool off.
Right on, man. Hey, who are the guys you want to thank for helping out today? Because I know you had a bunch of people out there cheering, pointing lines, keeping this bike on the track, man. I know you got a lot of people in your corner.
First off, I'd like to thank my mom, my dad, the whole Coaster Racing squad, Mike Gein, Tyler Ward, all my friends that came in here, all my family, Tyler King, my mechanic, Scott Kiger, Barry Hawk, Eli Kiger, Waynesburg Yamaha, Maxxis Tires, MSR, Pro Taper, DWT Wheels, FMF, Bell Ray, Bell Helmix, Garnet Boots, Acerbix, FMF Pites, Dirtworks, Twin Air, IMS, Maxxis Tires, Lone Star Racing, Bell Ray, MSR Gear, everybody, all the awesome fans out there cheering for us. You guys were great. You made us push all the way hard to the finish. Thank you very much.
Awesome. A great day for Bryce and Neil. One more time, put your hands together for third place today, you guys. We're going to make our way over here. We might have to turn down another speaker. Hey, Chris, you want to step up here? Get us a little room in between these speakers, man. Chris Borsch, I told you 2 weeks ago when you came off the track, man, you rolled the dice, taking some chances, laying on the line, man. And it's a new Chris Borsch, man. New Chris Borsch on Old Yella, making it look easy. And you know what? Always a smile on your face these days, and I love that.
Yeah, definitely. We're definitely having fun again. And got a pretty good start there. Got off the jump and got down in a creek and just soaked my hands. And it was just really hard to hold on there. And they got away from me a little bit. But towards the end there, we had a pretty good battle, me and Bryson going on there. And it was good fun.
I got to tell you, you've ridden a similar machine in the past. You know, you've changed settings a lot. How much better is this machine now than it was round one?
Definitely a lot better. We haven't really changed too much, but just me getting comfy back on the bike again, basically taking a year off from riding it and getting back on it. Just a little different, but we're getting there.
Buddy, who are all the people we're going to share the love with today?
You go back here.
Right on.
Definitely my mom and my dad. Without them, they obviously I wouldn't be up here. My wife, Dawn, her whole family came out. My buddy, Steve, his wife. Just everybody back at home that helps out and puts put the work in. The McCormick's Brian McCormick and Alicia and the Hunters, everybody that's behind me on that part. I appreciate it. And definitely Maxxis Tires, Wiseco, CV4, Scott Goggles, Renthal Bars, Four Works, Acerbis, Yield Cycle Barn, SSI Decals for keeping this thing look fresh. Fox Shocks, we're working awesome. Tire Balls, Evans Coolant for keeping it cool. Hyper Wheels, NRG Controls, Trek, IQ Products, VP Fuels, Precision, Walsh Racing, HMF, Amsoil, Fly Racing, Shoei, All Balls. If I forgot anybody else, I mean, thanks for everything.
Hey, congratulations. Let's hear it, Millfield, for number two today, Chris Borsch. Over here in the middle of the podium. Step on up here, Walker. Tell us a little bit about it, man. When you got out front today, it just looked like you had one thing in mind and one thing only. You were going to win. You weren't going to accept anything less, man.
Yeah, like I've been saying, and I've been saying it a while, and Adam's been keeping me super honest. It's we're to the point now where we got to start winning, and we got to start getting that points gap build back up. But like I said, Adam definitely kept us honest all day. I had a heck of a first lap. I felt phenomenal out front. And it just got tight that second lap and lost a lot of time, and Adam made up a lot of time, and he was rolling for sure. I knew it was going to be a long day. Third lap, he was even closer. We started getting into lap riders. I knew a lot of good spots where passes could be made, and was trying to take lines to block it, and all of a sudden Adam wasn't behind me, and I haven't exactly heard what happened, but you know, these guys ended up sneaking by him too, so it must have been whatever happened was a pretty big deal, but it was going to be exciting regardless. But I think we came in prepared and ready, and we have been for these last three races, but
just got some funk and you know, some weird luck. So I'm glad today to put it out front early and just ride my own race and have fun. I haven't had fun in a while, but man, these Ohio fans and this Ohio dirt, it's impossible not to have fun. So thank you guys. You guys are awesome. It's so dang fun. We had so much fun.
Got to appreciate these fans, no doubt about it. And you got to appreciate all the help you got behind you, all the people in your corner, man.
Absolutely. First and foremost, I want to give the glory to the good Lord above. Got to give it up to my man, Mark Notman here. He works so hard in the shop. Works, you know, a 30-hour work week in my dad's shop and puts in another 40 in my shop. So the guy's never home. His awesome family, Tom Notman, Liz Notman, they do a lot behind the scenes. My awesome parents, Mom, Dad, thank you so much. My beautiful girlfriend's watching back home. Thank you. Miss you. My whole Florida family. Appreciate all my fans here, man. Thank you, the Fanatics, and everyone that wants to be one. Thank you, everybody that's watching at home. Thank you, guys. Now we're actually going to get the sponsors, so bear with me. There's a lot, but there's a lot of people that that help earn these wins. Hawaiian Fat Bamper Yamaha team, Toby Reed at Moto Experts. This thing is lighting up on that line. That makes my life a lot easier. Thank you, Toby. Maxxis Tires, man. These guys have been filming with us all week. We're going to put a little project out. It's going to be really cool, but these Maxxis tires, are I wouldn't run anything else. So got some test tires in the work, too. I'm pretty excited about. Hill International Trucks, MSR, Fox Suspension, DP Brakes, Tire Balls, Vortex, Outerwears, Precision Yamalu, Moto Seat, FMF, Anti-Gravity Batteries, Sycra, VP Fuels, Wise Co., Fuel Customs, Waynesburg Yamaha, Atlas Neck Braces. This thing is so comfortable. I mean, I love it. It's safe. It's a good product to have, guys. IMS CB4 webcams. Thank you, guys, again. That's the secret to this thing starting good. Also, like I said, the anti-gravity batteries, 24-volt start system is top of the notch stuff. DID chains, UITR, Bell helmets, Scott goggles. My guy Paul Turner. Appreciate everything he does behind the scenes. Indie Graphic Works. This thing always looks super sharp. D4 Power Sports and D&B Trucking. An at-home company, it's my dad's trucking company. Right down the street from that is A-plus Powder Coating, and they do an awesome job. But again, man, these fans, you guys are freaking awesome. Thank you guys so much.
Yeah, let's hear it. All right, we know what time it is now. We're going to grab these bottles. These guys are going to get that champagne spray going on. Chris, this whole row looks really thirsty right here. They look thirsty as can be.
Yeah, we'll fill them up.
Right on, dude. Stand back. Have some fun, you guys. Make some noise, Millfield, for our top three overall. One more time, Walker Fowler, Bryson Neal, and Chris Morris in second place.
Well, there you go, folks. That's our podium celebration for the XC1 class. And we always like to say, to the victor goes the spoils, and the spoils of GNCC, the sweet, sweet spray of champagne. Wow, I tell you, Fred Andrews, what a day, no doubt about it. Walker Fowler taking a win, Borch, and then Neal in third. A classic matchup right down to the wire there for second place. Adam McGill does save it for fourth place. Landon Wolf in fifth. Jay Shadron was sixth. Greg Covert was your seventh place finisher. He was your winner of the XC2 Pro-Am class, with Wesley Wolf finishing second in that class and eighth overall. Winner of the College A class was Devin Feehan. He finished ninth overall. And Hunter Hart out of Newfield, New York, second in the College A, 16-21 class, and he was 10th place overall. Man, talk about some wild and crazy things happening out here. That's certainly what has been going on. Well, that's going to wrap up this day of racing. We'll be back on air here in just a few moments with our UTV racing. The side-by-side is coming up about 4:30, my friends, and also a big night ahead of us as well. Was Wiseco going to be presenting a lot of fun things, including a clutch rebuild challenge and much, much more. Stick around and come back if you can on RacerTV.com. On behalf of all of us here at RacerTV.com, my co-announcers, Megawatt Matt Watson, and, of course, Mr. Fred Andrews, former GNCC champion himself, I'm Rodney Tomlin, saying good day, everybody.